Wednesday. My friends, as we kick off another global transmission, September 7th, 2016. This day undoubtedly marks a key point in the ongoing collapse of the globalist power structure. And Hillary Clinton is a symbol, a figurehead of that accelerating fall. Julian Assange has given folks a lot of hints about what's coming out in the data dumps to come. And he has said, we're going to play the clip in the next segment, that it's going to come in the next week. And he held up a secret marked CIA top secret document and said, this is what's going to be coming out. There are thousands of these. And of course, it's going to be the total proof out of her 33,000 deleted emails that she lied when she said there were no documents marked classified. And she was buying and selling these and trading them on the open market and trading access to the Chinese president. How can I be so blind? She wasn't just selling access to the U.S. president. She was, through the State Department, she was selling to the Chinese president. It goes on and on. It's always worse than I think. People say, oh, you exaggerate. Nine times out of ten, no, we get it wrong. It's worse than we said. And it gets crazier and crazier and crazier. And basically, the FBI can't do anything because they've been told Obama and Hillary will just declare martial law. And I have that from the highest levels, if they move. In fact, they've been told, we're going to physically come after you. And I've been contacted by two major police departments the last 48 hours, and I had other police officers contact me and said, have you gotten the word? The Justice Department's coming in. They're here now with the UN, and Black Lives Matter is basically going to take over the police review boards. This is exactly what you said. I know. I mean, it's public documents, but it's now happening. It's now happening. This is a criminal takeover. They have nothing to lose. Here's Donald Trump pointing out that we've learned in the latest FBI data dump, we've got everybody doing leaks on Clinton. I mean, what else can you do to try to stop the criminal syndicate that she had two top aides in there smashing phones with hammers when they were on planes, when they were at their office? They always had hammers right there in case, you know, the cops blow the door open, start smashing the microchips. That's how criminal they are. That's beyond Al Capone, you know, with a fire going at his document office, which they mentally had in case the FBI showed up. Computer programs to wipe servers. I mean, you're talking mafia stuff. Here's Donald Trump as we go out to break on that subject.
People who have nothing to hide don't smash phones with hammers. They don't. People who have nothing to hide don't bleach. Nobody's ever heard of it. Don't bleach their emails or destroy evidence to keep it from being publicly archived as required under federal law. And she got rid of these emails after Congress, not before, after Congress requested them.
That's right. Think of that.
Can you imagine if I or somebody else did that? Can you imagine if Rudy Giuliani did that? Oh, Rudy, you'd be in such trouble. Poor Rudy. Right? It's unbelievable. Folks.
All right. So we're going to go to break. We're going to come back, play that clip again, and then I'm going to get to the big bombshell of the year so far. Assange basically tipped his hand. He's got all those emails that Hillary said just disappeared accidentally and got deleted. And it proves she's a criminal. Ladies and gentlemen, I wouldn't say the news we have is any cause for celebration or pulling out the cigars and champagne. To quote the wolf from Pulp Fiction, it's not time to really start celebrating yet. He had a certain way of saying it that I thought was funny. But we are very, very close to that point. The problem is, as Dr. Pechenik and others said last week, the big danger is now the globalist lion is wounded, is flopping around, bleeding to death, and we all need to be watching not just our six, but our 360. every point up. Because this is the season of false flags. This is the season of staged events. Now we're learning what's in the thousands and thousands and thousands of pages of data dump that the FBI released last week. So we got WikiLeaks putting out info. We've got the FBI putting out info. We've got U.S. press leaking info. We have federal agencies that have patriots in them leaking us info. And Hillary Rodham Clinton's response to all of this is to say that we're Russian agents, because Russia is somewhat aligned, obviously, against the warmongering neocons that infest and run the Obama and now future Clinton administration. No evidence, no proof, no nothing. The truth is, the entire world is really, really concerned and upset about what's happening on this planet, and is worried about the globalists, the multinational interests that have seized control of our government and that are using our government and our weapon systems and our propaganda systems and our wealth and our good credit and our name to loot the planet and start a bunch of wars and then flood the West with unskilled immigrants to complete political checkmate here. And Vladimir Putin has come out and said, we have the documents, which the Russians did hack, from the UN, that they were going to create a global government, a global carbon tax. And the Russians basically took credit for that. And I say, good job. Thank you for exposing the plan to shut down our coal industry. Thank you for exposing the plan to destroy our energy systems, just as it's meant to destroy Russia. The globalists are attacking everybody. But that's as far as this goes. But Hillary says the Russians are going to be involved in our elections. So we've got to have homeland security run by the real globalists, the people that have taken over, the real threat. And that Donald Trump is run by Vladimir Putin as well. And that I am. This is beyond McCarthyism. This is ridiculous in spades. And we have a special report that I shot last night that should be ready towards the end of the broadcast today. It's very powerful, very detailed, and documents the plan to steal the U.S. election by the multinationals that are now in control of our country by fraud. They know we're trying to struggle free, just like the Brexit. This is a historic moment. What we're seeing is 21st century warfare. And the sleeping giant that is free people all over the planet is awakening right now in a big, big way. Now, what is the mega bombshell news? Well, it's obviously that in those thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of pages of documents that the FBI released in 21st century warfare, that's what it is now. It's about documents. It's about exposing things. It's about info war, not the Russians, the FBI. I wouldn't be surprised if Hillary didn't come out and say the FBI, you know, is working with the Russians. I mean, Bill already said the FBI director, who let her off very, very mildly with a slap on the wrist, was full of BS. No, you did have illegal emails. You lied about having the server to begin with. You used gnome de plumes. You violated the Freedom of Information Act. You absconded once there was a congressional investigation. And now we learn in the FBI data dump, the aides testified that they didn't have phones anymore because they'd smashed them with a ball peen hammer. And that they carried a hammer with them on aircraft and in hotels and in their briefcases and in their offices, so that if the police started knocking down the door, they were to smash the phones. Oh, and there's a missing laptop. You don't shred laptops or crush laptops or microwave laptops now or use a hammer. You mail them and they disappear into the Phantom Zone. So we've seen that being sentenced to the Phantom Zone. Now, the big news is not just this information, but it dovetails. This is the caboose. The big news, the engine, the little engine that could, is Julian Assange, a true liberal, a true patriot for humanity, proven bipartisanly he would go after Republicans and go after Democrats just as hard, incredible courage, persecuted, a hero, an absolute hero. Time would always tell he is a hero. 8 years of being a stalwart, steadfast patriot. He goes on Sean Hannity last night That's where real liberals have to go, and says, I have the document right here. There are thousands of these. She had classified documents. That's what's coming out. That's what was some of what was in the deleted emails. So total proof she lied to Congress, total proof she lied to the FBI, total proof. We already have a lot of proof, but this is ridiculous proof. Total cornered rat. So let's play the Assange clip from Sean Hannity last night. This is Julian Assange saying another data dump's coming, like Chinese water torture, in the next few days to a week. Here it is.
It's not really hard to hack into these even secure systems, is it? I've talked to some real smart computer friends of mine. They say it's far more simple than anybody would ever know. Is that true?
It is. I just want to say one thing. In the FBI report released Friday, I agree with your analysis. It is very strange that was released Friday afternoon on a Labor weekend. I do think it draws questions as to what sort of game the FBI is trying to play. But there is... Hillary Clinton says that she can't remember what a C in bracket stands for. Everyone in positions of government and in WikiLeaks knows it stands for classified confidential. And in fact, we have already released thousands of cables by Hillary Clinton. Here she is, Clinton. See, that's her signature, Clinton, with a C in bracket right there.
Wow.
Thousands of examples where she herself has used this C in brackets and signed it off, and more than 22,000 times that she has received cables from others with this C in brackets. So it's absolutely incredible for Clinton to lie. She is lying about not knowing what that is. But it's a bit disturbing that James Comey goes along with that game.
Wow.
Now, that said, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to see a lot more of these coming out. Hillary was trained as a spy. Hillary worked at the State Department. Hillary worked in the Watergate hearings and got kicked off the hearings because she was making up evidence against Nixon. This woman has been a criminal mastermind since college, her and Bill. And of course she knows what classified is. She had all these stolen emails and documents that she was basically trading on the open market. That's why her aides, it's in the news today, are being investigated for destroying the information with a hammer and then using other programs to bleach the emails. Clinton aide destroyed Hillary's phones by breaking them in half or hitting them with a hammer, FBI document reveals. And again, they would carry the hammers on airplanes. They would take hammers with them in their briefcases because that's what you do when you're a spy covering up the evidence. Imagine if the police had a search warrant out, which Congress did when the phones got destroyed, saying, give us all the information. And then 33,000 emails go missing. And then the devices themselves that might have copies of it get destroyed. Imagine if the police were knocking down the door right now, and I had a ball-peen hammer about to smash multiple phones like Hillary Clinton's aides did.
Alex, actually, the police is here.
What? What, Ellie?
The FBI, they're here.
Oh, my gosh. Okay. You're serious. Why?
I'm 100% serious. They're here.
All right, hold on. Excuse me. This is totally normal. Ellie, thank you. Just go ahead and talk to them for a few minutes. Give them some coffee. Don't bring them in quite yet. Hold on. I'm having problems. Hold them back. I'm completely innocent. I know nothing about classification. Hey, guys, I haven't destroyed these completely. I mean, I haven't... hold on a minute. One drop on the floor. Get it in here quick. Hold them back. Hold them. One fell on the floor. Fine, I'll go over there and get it. Bring me the one off the floor. Bring them back over here, guys, because I got to get rid of these completely. In fact, can any of you maybe run out the back door with these? Can I have that one, please, Nico? I mean, I'm trying to not get rid of evidence here. I'm not getting rid of evidence. No, I'm not. Nothing's happening, all right? The government loves you. Hillary Clinton cares about you and your family. We're going to have to go to break here. No, I'm being sarcastic, ladies and gentlemen. Well, that really made a mess. I am being illustrative of the absurdity that we have now reached in this country where... Hillary's been caught at the furnace or the shredder as the feds bust in, throwing documents in like out of the movie The Untouchables or something. This is getting absolutely insane. And that's why I illustrated this by being absurd because this is absurd. And we are about to see more come out from WikiLeaks that's even more powerful. And that's why Hillary's in panic mode. So ask yourself, what are the globalists who admit their New World Order is doomed if Hillary fails on the heels of the Brexit? What are they going to pull their bacon out of the fire? It'll be an epic broadcast because it's an epic time. It's a historic time. Infowars.com. I'm Alex Jones. So if you just joined us during the last segment for TV viewers, I narrated for radio listeners, I took a hammer similar to the ball peen hammer that Hillary and her aides carried with them to destroy computer chips, data chips, memory chips in two cell phones, two outdated office phones from many years ago. Now, if there was a subpoena out, that would have been a serious felony crime of destruction of evidence, absconding, the list goes on and on. And because orders were coming down to do it, it then turns into racketeering. It turns into a conspiracy. And that's where we've got Hare Hillary lying to Congress over and over again. We've already caught her in a whole bunch of lies, but this is red-handed. This is the actual emails, and then it's the selling of data. It's the influence peddling. It's the selling access to the president and to the State Department and to other agencies and to foreign presidents that is particularly criminal. So it's not just proving she lied and deleted the emails and that they were classified. Thousands and thousands of them, as Assange just said, he has the copies. They've already released some of them. He's going to release thousands more next week. But that's just some of it. It's coordination between the media heads and the Clinton operation and the White House. Direct orders on what to do and plans to shut down the free media, plans to have the UN take over the internet, plans to shut down talk radio. And by the way, this has already come out in previous DC leaks. With George Soros directing all that. And of course, that's from a few years ago. Notice October 1st, the UN begins the process of taking the internet over. And they'll do the classic straw man where they'll say, oh, well, notice the internet's still here today. You know, they said it would all be gone October 1st. Kind of like Alex Jones said in 2015 that by the end of the summer, there'd be martial law. Jade Helm never said any such thing. But they build straw men. And it's so lazy how they build these straw men. So in what's left of the segment, I'm going to show you, TV viewers and radio listeners, a straw man example. I have seen this article basically word for word, let's not exaggerate, thousands of times. Sometimes I'm attacked in thousands of articles a day. Usually it's just dozens, 30, 40, 50, 100. I mean, I guess a light day is 100 or so. I'm turning down like 15 major profiles right now. I'm not bragging, but I mean, you name it. New Yorker Magazine, London Guardian, New York Times, you name it. I just turn it all down because it's just going to be an attack. It's just going to be them pretending that they met with me and actually heard what I had to say, pretending to be journalists. But I do like to just illustrate when I attack back, not to even to defend myself, but to illustrate how this propaganda works on myself, Trump, and others. Now, you can go out and even find this article with the same headline. The five most kooky, the five most tinfoil hat, the five most insane, or the 10 most, or the 20 most. I mean, it's always the same article. And this is word for word, basically, what I've read hundreds of times. I've seen the articles thousands of times, but I've read this hundreds of times, so have you. This is from the Libertarian Republic, which I guess you can translate that means apologist for Gary Johnson, who wants open borders, gun control, TPP, carbon taxes, and thinks Hillary's a great person, close quote. A great public service, excuse me. When you read the article, it misrepresents what I've said and then does straw men. It says, conspiracy theorist Jones has a penchant for the absurd. Number one, the government is making people gay. No, I said that bisphenol A and other chemicals are actually causing the sex in many animals, including mammals, to be hermaphroditic or twisted or deformed. And it is creating sexual confusion in studies, and it shows in mammals across the board and is causing more what you'd call homosexual activity. That's only one aspect of this, but that's scientific fact. So that's a misrepresentation right there. And again, you've all heard this attack over and over again. Juice boxes, you know, make kids gay. Okay, now continuing. Number two, Obama is Al-Qaeda. No, Obama and the globalists helped fund Al-Qaeda, protect Al-Qaeda, and it turned into ISIS. You have to understand, ladies and gentlemen, that's an admitted fact. That's been in congressional hearings. General Flynn's talking about that. We mainlined that. Donald Trump's talking about it. They're telling their readers I'm a kook and basically a liar. Oh, here it is in media today. New ISIS military commander was trained by the State Department as recently as 2014. Oh, that's mainstream media reporting on that. CNN. That's today. CNN. Oh, but I'm a kook. Okay, well, let's just continue through these. The government sent weather weapons to Oklahoma. No, I didn't say that. I said the government has weather weapons. That's even on the Discovery Channel and History Channel. But you talk to your readers like they don't exist. This is an attack piece back because I exposed Gary Johnson. What a joke. Thank you for these attacks. You're a joke. And I only single you out because you're a little minion. Empires, you need to be exposed. Can't you even write some new BS? I mean, you just went and cut and paste this like mommy does? Duncan, you're in. All right, Roger Stone, former head of the Trump campaign and weekly guest on the show, just pushed his interview back into the fourth hour today, which I'll now be hosting part of. Because he's got some really big breaking news for us on top of the other important news he was going to be breaking. James Wesley Rawls, one of the top survivalist experts, former Army intelligence officer, really smart guy, who predicted pretty much everything we're now facing. That's the top folks we have on, people that are accurate. He'll be not people that lie, you know, like mainstream media just has people on because they're liars and will say whatever they're told. He's going to be joining us in the second hour. Freeway Rick Ross, not the fake rapper that stole the identity, in my opinion, of Freeway Rick Ross, will be joining us. Freeway Rick Ross, the real Rick Ross, will be joining us. I don't even know his view on this. I didn't check it. He is the famous gentleman that was bringing in for the CIA $25 million a day of cocaine into South Central Los Angeles. He was friends with Gary Webb. You've seen the film based on Gary Webb and Rick Ross, Kill the Messenger, that won major awards. Very accurate film, by the way. It's almost like a documentary. I was sick when I walked out of it. Never really had that experience before because I knew Gary Webb and knew all the players, basically, and was covering it at the time and was about to have him on the show with his new book that double-proved everything. And when he was executed, two gunshots to the head, and then they had operatives come out and attack myself and others, and Rick Ross saying that it's quite normal to shoot yourself twice in the head. And then he was so depressed because he'd been disproven. He'd been proven to be a fraud when none of that was true. He'd been proven to be deadly accurate. But I don't know Rick Ross's view on this, but I thought, why not get him on about Hillary Clinton and the crime laws that they passed in the 90s that would give black people 3 to 5 times the sentencing time, basically, that it would give whites or other affluent people that tended to use powdered cocaine. And with the cliche, it'd be like saying if you're drinking Coors Light, you get probation. If you're drinking Schlitz malt liquor, you get 10 years. That's basically what it is. You're snorting powdered cocaine, you get probation the first time. If you're smoking crack, you get a huge sentence. And so I just thought we'd actually get his take on an actual CIA drug dealer, certified, congressional hearings, whole nine yards. We'd hear from him on this subject. So Rick Ross will be joining us. And then Roger Stone pushed back his interview. I'll be co-hosting that with David Knight coming up for the first half of the fourth hour today. So a jam-packed transmission, should have told you that at the start of the show. Now, again, I have hundreds of articles here. That's all incredibly important. Tons of special reports I want to get to. But I want to go back to what I was covering in the last segment. If you just joined me, let me recap this. And I just chose this today because I've seen this type of article over 1,000 times. This article is the number one attack piece they put out against me. You can pull up. In fact, I want to do a nightly news piece on this and actually show it. Like crazy things Alex Jones says or the most insane things Alex Jones says. And you will read pretty much in the same order in many of the articles how I'm attacked here and none of it's true. The reason I decided to cover it is because it's from one of these libertarian websites. And I got to tell you, I'm really ashamed of the Libertarian Party. I'm no longer going to call myself a libertarian. You have ruined it. You have destroyed the good name of it for a long period of time. Gary Johnson and his neocon warmongering cohort, who wants to ban all guns that hold over 5 rounds, who wants open borders and for us to pay for everybody's anchor babies and the rest of it, who is for all these big private prisons, who is pushing the TPP, global government, and who thinks Hillary, quote, is a wonderful public servant. And so I come out and attack him, and they've had a coterie of so-called libertarian sites come out and attack me. I love it. Please separate me from you. Could you do it a little bit more? Because you know, when I break things off with sellouts, when I break things off with Judas Iscariots, with Benedict Arnolds, I want it to be a big, fat, juicy break. Because you see, Donald Trump, David Knight walks with me in the hallway yesterday, and he said this. He said, this is what happened. I said, you're absolutely right. Tomorrow I'm going to say that. But we should tweet this out. Donald Trump took over the Republican Party for the populists. Gary Johnson took over the Libertarian Party for Hillary Clinton and the globalists. That's it. And there's people playing games like, oh, this was a party. I'm for Gary Johnson because he's not in a party. He's the globalist party. They've taken over the Libertarian Party, and that is a party. It's what someone stands for. I've been all about building third parties, building Libertarian Party. But I'm telling you, what I've seen and how the Libertarian establishment loves being brought in and worshipped on CNN and Fox News and the establishment kissing the Libertarians on the forehead and petting them and patting them on the head and the Libertarians hopping around excitedly like, we finally matter. Oh, wow, this is great. You are a bunch of social justice warriors, snot noses. Now, the real libertarians, and that's 90% of them, are horrified. On the libertarian websites, in the comments, and on the street, everyone is just basically vomiting our relationship and our connection to the Libertarian Party out of our guts. Now, it doesn't mean it can be taken back over again in the future. But until the libertarians in general recognize the Libertarian Party is a captured hill, that it is a captured fort, that it is an occupied vessel. The Libertarian Party is finale. It is final. It is over. It is kaput. It is defunct. It is gone. It is deep six. It is 6 feet under. It's in Davy Jones's locker. It's at the bottom of the ocean. Just like America's been taken over. I don't say that to put America down. We have to admit we're in trouble before we can turn around. So I'm exposing it because it's a libertarian establishment, you know, the captured libertarian outpost, just regurgitating the same article I've seen over and over again. Top five insane Alex Jones conspiracy theories. Conspiracy theorist Jones has a penchant for the absurd. The government is making people gay. And they take out of context one little clip saying the juice boxes are making Junior gay. In the studies I just read out of mainstream news that day, 5-6 years ago, there's been thousands of articles on this alone. I showed mainstream Journal of Science, you name it. Everybody knows about the plastics making the fish bisexual, the frogs bisexual, asexual, both sexual organs, destroying fertility, increasing cancers. I showed BBC headlines about Pentagon created a gay bomb that they can spray on men, and it makes any male mammal start just going after other males via the pheromones. They think their readers aren't going to go Google that. I mean, just type in the gay bomb. Pentagon developed a gay bomb. They think you're stupid. They'll just play that on national news. They played it on Colbert like 5 years ago and said, this man is insane. No, I know how to read it. In fact, guys, just go to Google. Pentagon developed gay bomb. Can we put that in and put it on screen real quick, please? I want to show TV viewers this so that people can understand. Pentagon, here, it's real quick. I'll go to Google and do it. Having some trouble on the search. No big deal. I can do it. Here we go. Okay. There you go. Gay bomb, Wikipedia. You guys are clicking news. You want to click web. When something's old, I think that's one little thing I got to teach folks, that you want to hit web when it's old. If it's brand new, click news. Go ahead. BBC, as I told everybody, U.S. military pondered love, not war, dropping gay gas on people. Okay, boom, just disproved number one. Let's continue here through these, and I'm going to get back into the huge news. This isn't about me, though. This is about exposing how they lie and how they're too lazy to write more than one article. They just vomit it into the mouth of the next group, and then they vomit it and pass it around in this big vomit fest. circle vomit. Number two, Obama is Al-Qaeda. General Flynn's out there saying it, that Hillary and Obama are the founders of modern Al-Qaeda and ISIS, and the whole world knows about it. There's congressional hearings, so I don't have to even go through the documentation on that. You think your readers are morons. Let's move to the next one. Number three, the government can control the weather to create tornadoes and hurricanes. That was declassified in 2003, and it's since been documentaries on History Channel, Discovery Channel, everywhere. And then they misrepresent, saying that I said they sent a tornado to Oklahoma. I didn't. I said they have weather-causing weapon systems. That's mainstream news. So, boom, disproven there. Let's continue again. This is what they do. Atheists are actually occultists. I didn't say all atheists. I said atheism being taught in schools, the globalist pushing one world religion, people that say that they don't believe in God and that make fun of the spiritual at the highest levels many times turn out to be occultists. I'm an expert on Skull and Bones, Bohemian Grove. I've traveled the world documenting this. The occultists do not want you to even study the different systems they're into. But you should study Luciferianism. You should study Satanism, eugenics, and other religions that these people follow. Now, let's continue. Let's go to number five, because this person was particularly lazy. You know, they got these that go like 20, 30 deep. Mass shootings are false flags. No, I didn't say all mass shootings were false flags. There have been times when there are multiple shooters, when there are cover-ups, when mentally ill people are allowed to go attack. There absolutely have been cases of false flags, and some of those have been declassified. So there you go. And, of course, we even have Operation Northwoods, where the Pentagon wanted to engage in mass shootings and bombings to blame Cuba and to be able to launch a war with the Soviet Union. But L.L. Lemnitzer and General Curtis LeMay were fired by Dwight D. Eisenhower when they proposed it to him. They then again brought it to JFK, who did not go along with the proposal. But even Frontline reported 8 years ago in a declassified report that Bobby Kennedy wasn't an angel when he was the attorney general, that he was working with the CIA to bomb the U.S. Honduran embassy as an excuse to invade Honduras. Boom. Hit you hard again. How do you like that? That's just small smidgens of the large histories here for, what was the name of this libertarian? Oh, so this false libertarian, in my view, a faux libertarian. This is the Libertarian Republic, which I guess loves the TPP that ends the Republic. Absolutely ridiculous. So, I covered that. I'm done. Now, let's get back into the huge news if you just tuned into the broadcast. The thousands of pages in the FBI data dump of last Friday that was released like flatulence into a church so that no one would notice has now broken 3-4 days later when the mainstream media has been giving their walking orders on how to spin this. But the dinosaur media may move slowly, but they're now on the job, just mixing it in with all the past email stories. But hidden in there is the fact that you have Hillary aides admittedly telling the FBI that they would carry hammers around and smash the phones if they thought anyone was coming for them, and that when they got the congressional subpoenas for them, they smashed them with hammers. If that isn't archetypal covering up evidence, if that isn't breaking the law, that isn't destruction of evidence. If this doesn't bring down Hillary, I don't know what will. But don't worry, even bigger stuff's coming out next week. And the founder of WikiLeaks went on Fox News last night to say that thousands of pages more showing that she knew that it was classified are going to be coming out. And one of those stories, like all these stories, are on Infowars.com. WikiLeaks, Assange says new Hillary bombshell could drop next week. He likes to get them off balance, though. But he's going to be dribbling this out, and I'm told the big servings will come on the eves of the debates. But speaking of debates, we're going to have live coverage tonight of the so-called debate. It's not really a debate. It's the armed services event where you'll have 30 minutes for Hillary and then 30 minutes for Trump with prepared questions with a member of the Clinton Worldwide Initiative Foundation, Matt Lauer, asking the questions. And they're going to try to stump Trump. They know his strongest suit is with the military. They know he's got all these top generals advising him, so they want to make him look stupid, make her look smart. This is where they're going to try to set the tone, and if she doesn't get a major score tonight, Hillary will try to cancel the debates. Mark my words, she cannot even talk 5 minutes without having a giant conniption fit. So we'll have more on that, but we're going to have live coverage while it's on tonight, 7 o'clock Central, live news, covering it, analyzing it, breaking it down. People ask, how do you do that? We started trailblazing doing live events like this during the last election 4 years ago. And people said, well, how do you do that? It's copyright. We're not playing the whole thing. We're analyzing it as an event. It's political. It's not a football game. It's under different law. So people ask me, can I stick InfoWars on my card? Is it copyright? No. Like people saying, oh, we don't have to do a Trump cake because Trump 2016 is copyright. No, it's not. It's in public parlance. It's publicly used. It's a political campaign. It's grassroots. You can't do that. It's ridiculous. But again, people have no understanding of copyright, and that's why they're bringing in this new UN-TPP copyright that basically says you couldn't do that. So that's what Albertson's Bakery is now doing. Oh, say, oh, gay wedding may be copyright. Sorry, can't do it. If it's for individual use, it's your exercise of free speech. You can have that put on your cake. But this is how corporations want to basically oppress people with blown out, out of control versions of copyright. More details on the event, not the debate, coming up in the next segment. But before I go any further, September is preparedness month. And the German government came out 2 weeks ago and said, prepare for a massive civil emergency, get food and water. We're sitting here not knowing what it is. Probably the collapse of Deutsche Bank and other major German banks that'll make Lehman Brothers look like a blip on the radar screen. All I know is global collapse has gone from a possibility to a probability to a certainty in many areas. It's already ongoing. So I've doubled down on the amount of storable food I have. The best quality food out there for the lowest price for this type of, you know, high quality food is InfoWars Select brand that is the full spectrum of My Patriot Supply, but always discounted roughly 10% off their food, which we also sell side by side at InfoWarsStore.com, and then it's drop shipped from them the same day. Unless it's the weekend, then it's a few days later. The point is immediate shipping, okay, in an industry where obviously it's fraught with hangups. This is the one of the top companies in the country because it's such quality and such great service. Well, we are their major retailer. And it's InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsSelect.com, takes you right to the food. Full spectrum, special meals, whatever you need, a very wide spectrum, InfoWarsStore.com or InfoWarsSelect.com, 30 to 40% off. And we used to do this only once a year. I've been doing it every few months because people need to get prepared. We got 20% off air filtration systems of the very best, Game Changers, Alexa Pure at InfoWarsStore.com. We have 20% off on the Alexa Pure water filtration systems and a lot of other specials that are going right now. InfoWarsLife.com is where you find all the nutraceuticals. And we've got 20% off on Survival Shield Nascent Iodine X2 right now. 20% off also on Vitamin Mineral Fusion Fruit Punch. All of this stores really well, and it's important to have a backup supply of. Look at what just happened again in Louisiana and surrounding areas. But I don't really have all this for emergencies like that. I mean, even though that they can still happen. The real threat is that the globalists want everybody to be totally dependent on the system and not self-sufficient. Obviously, we're moving in the direction of trying to get self-sufficient. And we fund our operation, providing the public with high-quality sources of products that we all need. It's a 360 win. I want to thank you all for your support. The toll-free number to call and order or ask any questions is 888-253-3139. I'm Alex Jones. This is the InfoWar. If it sounds like I'm excited, if it sounds like I want to be on the air, it's because I do. We are witnessing history. And I know I keep saying that every day more and more, but we really are. We are witnessing the world battling the crime syndicates, the oligarchs, the globalists that have taken control of our country. Kit Daniels just walked in with a new article by Clifford Cunningham, one of our great new investigative journalists, who's been knocking it out of the park with links on Drudge, WorldNet Daily picking up the stories, you name it, really having a big effect. Report, Goldman Sachs bans donations to Trump campaign. And you read Politico, Politico's like, oh yeah, Goldman Sachs won't let it, you know, them give any money to anyone that is a sitting state official. when Goldman Sachs is famous for basically running everything. And that's being done late in the game, because now that means Goldman Sachs employees cannot give to the Trump campaign. But don't worry, none of them have given anyways. They're the biggest corporate donor to Hillary. If you talk about individual donors, it's Carlos Slim. Carlos Slim is such an El Jefe, they say he's not corrupt. How many billions has Carlos Slim gotten from U.S. taxpayers? Last time I checked, it was something like $4 billion. That was a few years ago, for Obama phones. Obama phone. He gave us a phone. Gonna do more. Remember that lady? Nice lady. We had her here. Sweet lady. What's her name? I forget. I'll have her back. But the point is that Slim was getting the money, and by the way, way more than they were worth, and administering it. They screw us over seven ways to Sunday, and then he repays the favor by owning the New York Times and spewing BS 24/7. Oh, the paper of record, owned by a big, fat, slimy, he's not even a Mexican kingpin. He's from the Middle East. See, it's lies within lies. He's not even a Mexican. He's an Arab. I'm not against Arabs. There's a lot of great, you know, Arab folks out there. The point is you can't make this stuff up. You just can't do it. By the way, you go look at a Mexican Congress meeting. It's run by a bunch of 6'5" white people. In fact, I'd be considered, compared to a lot of the members of the Mexican Congress, as like kind of a dark-skinned fellow. I'm serious. And I'm not, you know, have the noble brow and 6'4" and, you know, have a German or a Spanish last name. And, you know, and I'm not related to Juan Carlos either of Spain. I just love how Mexico oppresses its people and then plays all this race card garbage all day when it's totally controlled by the New World Order. But I don't even want to say controlled. I mean, it's like they have a seat at the New World Order. Mexico is incredibly influential in the world. And their people are in a living hell because they're seen as totally expendable. So I happen to have studied the cultures in Latin America. On average, Latin American cultures are super racist towards black people. Let's talk about Brazil. And then the upper white class is about as racist as you can get. But it's not even racist. It's like a classist system. I'm sorry, I'm digressing with a little history lesson here. It's just, give me a break. I am really fed up with all of this. By the way, speaking of crooks, Nicolas Sarkozy has been indicted. He will stand trial for financing an illegal elections campaign. And of course, it's not that Sarkozy's good. Hollande's horrible, too. They're all corrupt. They've all been caught doing horrible things. But anyone that runs basically against the socialists gets indicted. And Sarkozy's a conservative. He only wants an 80% tax. I'm not kidding. Hollande wants a 101% tax. I mean, in fact, they've had it for 2 years. Look it up. I'm not kidding. 101% tax. We'll be right back. Stay with us. You know, I better not read this headline, because every time I cover a top general or the head of NATO or the head of CENTCOM or the head of SOUTHCOM or top scientist or Stephen Hawking saying the world's never been in more danger than it is now. Obama, though, he says the world's never been safer. That's a quote. And the U.S. economy has never been better. Remember, he said that about a year ago. So should I read this headline out of the UK Sun? Planet closer to catastrophic World War III than at any time for 60 years, experts warn. And it doesn't look good for Britain or America if it does kick off. No, you want to get down to Easter Island? You want to get down, down, down. Down, 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 I'm going to take it down. It's when the dying goes. It's when the dying goes. I have actually, years ago, talked about evacuating to the Southern Hemisphere. It would be a very selfish move, but my flesh, that is weak for my family, is constantly making me angry at myself for not evacuating quickly. Another area that will get hit with less radiation is New Zealand. There aren't too many globalist billionaires that haven't hightailed it to New Zealand or Australia. In fact, that's in the news today. In the George Strait world, You know, here in Texas, we tend to think of ourselves as a redoubt against the globalists, the New World Order. But I can tell you, at current rates of their program, we'll be a lost cause within about 5 years. And I've pledged to stay here and go down with the ship. But I really don't want to be involved in a civil war when about half the public can't even wipe their noses. I mean, it is going to be just disastrous. And I really feel sorry for the general public, and I really feel sorry for the military and police. I really do. People say, oh, the cops are corrupt and scum. They're all just out there attacking innocent people 24/7. And the statistics just don't show that. The cops kill a little over 1,000 people a year. And they say only 100 and something aren't justified. Let's say it's 300 aren't justified. Is 300 dead people a year the big issue? By the way, this is why I've been having information overload. I mean, I almost don't even want all these guests to come on, even though they're great guests, informative, because I have a lot to cover. Leprosy is spreading all over the United States. And I've been told this by people at the state level in Florida and the state level in California. And I talked to a high-level individual in the state health department of Texas on the hike and bike trail parking lot about a year ago. And I'd recognized the guy on TV before. He knew who I was and came over. And I followed him over to his car. He had state plates, too. I mean, it was who he said he was. I went and Googled it right when I got in my car. And he said, just don't say my name, but yeah, you can say this. We are dealing with black plague, bubonic plague, and we are dealing with drug-resistant TB everywhere, drug-resistant syphilis, leprosy. And I said, really, leprosy? I heard there's a major uptick. And you go, oh, yeah, it's bad. And so, oh, by the way, wet leprosy, that's transferable leprosy, is basically untreatable. I mean, it's incurable. And so I told you it's spreading in the public schools, and it's CBS News outside Los Angeles. See, the school didn't know. They thought when there's been an outbreak of, like, chickenpox, that they want fear-mongering for vaccines, so they sent a letter. And the health department said, no, you don't send it when it's leprosy, sweetheart. Leprosy spreading in the school. One drippy touch, and your child is going to be rotting for the rest of their life. And guess who leaves the borders wide open and who won't let the Border Patrol do it? Yeah, that's a local paper. It's now confirmed with CBS. You can put CBS up on screen for folks. We're going to cover it all. Stay with us. From the front lines of the information war, I'm Alex Jones. We're now 9 minutes and 55 seconds into the second hour. For the rest of the hour, we have James Wesley Rawls joining us, best-selling author of both fiction and nonfiction, former Army intelligence officer. He's a humble guy, but I've talked to a lot of really smart people in the last decade, current military and former, and they say, James Wesley Rawls, he knows what he's talking about. And they also will kind of point you to other people like Bracken and others to break down. You know, they won't sit there and give you secret information. They'll just say, you ought to go talk to this person. And, of course, I have my head screwed on pretty straight, too. I've got a pretty clear view on what's going on here. But survivalblog.com is his award-winning website. We'll tell you about one of his latest novels and more while he's with us here today. But there's a lot of headlines here that are very, very illustrative of a Marie Antoinette-type breakdown of civilization that we see happening throughout history, where elites become very, very disconnected from reality and become megalomaniacal, start wars they can't win, or squander the public treasury to build monuments, and the public starves, and then there's a civil war, or they marry their horse and declare themselves God, you know, Caligula. And we see that. I mean, look at these headlines here. Planet closer to catastrophic World War III than any time for 60 years, experts warn. That's the Sun newspaper. And it doesn't look good for Britain or America if it does kick off. And it goes through all these top experts agreeing that the world's the most dangerous it's ever been. Obama says it's the safest it's ever been, and the economy is the best it's ever been. And then I have this headline of the LA Times. Beverly Hills homes seek $195 million in wake of record Playboy mansion sale. And why do I read that headline? Because it ties in with this. You see, when they've got chicken pox or something, that the school sends home letters to hype it so everybody takes vaccines. But when it's a real crisis, like drug immune or resistant TB, that'll kill you over time, you know, fry your liver and kidneys with just the antibiotics alone, they don't send letters home when there's TB in the school. Okay. And we have the headlines, Associated Press, 22% of the Islamic veterans, a lot of them are veterans of the jihad, 80% are male. That Freudian slip was, see, my Freudian slips are super accurate. Coming into Minnesota alone have drug resistant TB, which is a nice way of saying basically untreatable. But what else is exploding? And I've been told, I've told you about this, is being covered up. I've talked to high level folks in California and in Florida. And I've also talked to people in the state health department, high level here in Texas. And they say it's not just TB, it's black plague and it's leprosy. And the reason I want to mention this is, what's wrong with the elite? I've had the Border Patrol on with their faces blurred. We've gone down and showed them completing the smuggling process and being ordered to, you know, let them be shipped in. That was 3 years ago. We broke that. The media knew about it. They were just willing accomplices to cover it up. And when that happened, more and more Border Patrol came out, and then they got reprimanded. One of them went on Hannity, a senior Border Patrol agent, deputy head of the union nationally, and said, no, it's true. We complete the smuggling process. And the latest report from just a few months ago with our reporters on the border, and they talked to the Border Patrol. This time the Border Patrol went on camera, knowing they could be fired. The head of the union in that sector went on camera and said, we're ordered to let them all go, even if they've got TB, you name it. When they find out they have TB, they let them go. And they don't even give them medical care. And they send them, including children, to be in school with your kids. This is insane. It's a way to bring the country down. But the globalists themselves don't even care about their own operations. Or do they? Because more and more of them are running to New Zealand, Australia, and other areas. Even mainstream media is reporting on the giant exodus taking place. I wanted to set the table with that, with James Leslie Rawls, because we have a special report coming up later in the broadcast today. We have big breaking news with Roger Stone into the fourth hour today. I'm going to be co-hosting that with David Knight. But we have big breaking news. We have confirmed that they're bringing in UN, NATO, OECD security forces. That's at the base of the EU and NATO. That's what set up the Marshall Plan. So the actual corporation that runs Europe is sending its operatives in tenfold, Reuters reports, what we're here previously in the last 2012 election. And they're going to, quote, protect our elections from the Russians. Hillary even said that Monday during a coughing fit on her airplane in a quasi press conference she finally gave. So we've got that. We've got all these new emails coming out proving she destroyed classified evidence, but has been caught doing it. So we have her red-handed. What false flags will they launch? Every globalist publication, from the Financial Times of London to the Washington Post, The Economist, says if Hillary falls after Brexit, it's all going to fall. So we have entered a mythical time right now. This is so crazy. The best laid plans of mice and men often go astray. I'm going to skip this break so Rawls has more time. There's going to be a show soon if this keeps going this way. It's make it or break it. We've never had so much opportunity. It's the best of times, worst of times. We've never had so many problems. This is Newtonian physics. For every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. We are in the fulcrum. We are in the center of the maelstrom. We are in the center of the hurricane. That is my view. But every other analyst agrees that it, hands down, this is the most wild time to ever be alive. And things are very fluid now. The shape of things to come is happening now. James Wesley Rawls, I've thrown a huge spectrum out there, but it all ties together as a former Army intelligence officer. Somebody so concerned about what's happening, your face hasn't been seen in over a decade. Probably the top survival researcher and blog out there, I think, hands down. Do you concur with that breakdown, that gestalt? And what do you add to that? Because you'll have the floor. Give us a presentation. I'm going to try not to jump in until the bottom of the hour. Thanks for coming on.
Well, thank you for having me on, Alex. I have to agree with you that we are living in a very pivotal time, and that the outcome of the upcoming election has a lot to do with where this nation ends up in the near future. We're probably going to see a third world war within the next few years, regardless of who is elected. I'm hoping that wiser heads will prevail, but certainly if Hillary gets in, we are much more likely to be going head-to-head with a coalition of possibly Russia and China and one or more key players in the Middle East. It could be a absolute mess, and we could overtax the capabilities of our military to respond in a conventional manner and prevail. And given the proclivity of modern politicians, when backed into a corner, I think that there's a fairly high likelihood that this could go nuclear. We could see a nuclear conflict coming out of what looks like an unwinnable conventional warfare situation, where the U.S. is fighting a war on multiple fronts and simply overwhelmed and outnumbered. Yes, we have a fantastic military. We have some of the finest military aircraft out there. But sheer numbers might be what matters. And if it comes down to that, if we're facing multiple adversaries in multiple theaters, we could very well be overwhelmed.
And we could be looking at a option like they almost had in Korea when a million Chinese came in from the north and when MacArthur wanted to use atomic weapons.
Yes, it could come to something just about like that. And here we have a situation that's incredibly fluid where U.S. foreign policy has been adrift for many years. We have a U.S. State Department that's colluding with our enemies, and we have a situation where we basically, I'm really surprised that it didn't come to out-and-out combat over the Ukraine. We came very close with the Ukraine to going into a full-blown war with Russia. We could very well reach a tipping point like that in any number of different places, in Korea, in Iraq, in Syria, possibly in North Africa. Again, we could. I think there's more trouble brewing in Libya and with Sudan that's not being very well reported in the press, but the situation in Libya is far from settled. And the ISIS presence is growing there. So there's any number of different theaters where this could erupt into a full-scale war, and we could have, especially in the situation with Syria, where you have so many surrogate forces in operation, all it takes is a couple of aircraft being shot down, and the whole paradigm shifts, and alliances become clear. And then we would end up in combat, possibly
right.
Even with Turkey and even the Russians. It could be a very ugly situation very quickly. We have, a foreign policy that's been adrift for so many years, and we've been backstabbing so many of our allies, including Israel, that any number of different situations could spin very rapidly out of control. And as a backdrop to all of this, as you alluded to earlier, we have a economic situation globally that is teetering on the brink. And unfortunately, in the view of some politicians, they may see a third world war, or at least a regional war, as a convenient excuse and a means of escape.
That's right, a major reset.
An economic collapse.
A major reset in their view. In fact, they're even talking about that, as you know, and we've got the Chinese president, the appointed dictator, he has the name president, threatening war, saying it's imminent just a month ago in the Chinese People's Daily. We have unprecedented corruption. And then we have the Clinton Foundation bragging that the failed state is what they always wanted in Libya. What is the strategy there of turning ISIS and Al-Qaeda loose as a larger caliphate for Saudi Arabia to export it's Wahhabism, but now Saudi Arabia is suddenly jumping in bed with the Russians. Turkey is hedging its bets. I mean, these are the type of things we see before a major world war. That's what mainline analysts are now saying. Do you concur with this article out of the Sun, seeing planet closer to catastrophic World War III than any time for 60 years?
Yes, I do. And in fact, I think the situation in Syria is probably the most likely flashpoint. Because, again, as I mentioned before, there are so many surrogate forces in play. And right now, we have Turkey that is supposedly still our NATO ally prosecuting a war against the Kurds, who we have supported. And the Kurds have been really the only effective fighting force in combating ISIS in Syria. So, and we've only given them begrudging assistance, but...
Exactly. Obama and the globalists are trying to play every side. Sorry, go ahead.
Topsy-turvy.
You're absolutely right. What do you see in this election with Hillary, health issues? What's your view? What's your intel on that, Mr. Rawls?
Well, I don't have any direct intelligence, but common sense dictates that if she has a major health setback, more than just the little episodes that she's had with minor seizures, that we could very well see the Democratic Party trot out another candidate or perhaps even make her running mate the candidate, who's pretty much an unknown. And given the power of the mass media in this country, they may try to railroad Donald Trump right off the tracks and railroad in their candidate for the Democrat Party in the upcoming election. The polls have been wildly exaggerated and manipulated, and I think the poll number, the real poll numbers, the genuine numbers out there actually are leaning pretty solidly for Donald Trump.
Absolutely. But, in fact, internal polling shows that. And Reuters doesn't even hide it, the fact that they sampled 15% more Democrats in polls to give Hillary a lead. We're seeing unprecedented deception by the press, by the political class, really a wild-eyed behavior where Hillary never does press conferences, but you write questions on an orange and then roll it up to the front of the plane where she's at, and then the media makes a joke out of this. This is insane.
At least she hasn't appointed a horse to the Senate yet.
But, exactly.
We are definitely living in the age of deception and betrayal. And Hillary's hijinks, I think, are just one example of just how perverted the system has become and how out of touch with reality a lot of the political ruling class really are.
That's what scares me. When you've got a bunch of weird, power-tripping women in $5,000, $10,000 business suits with jewelry at defense briefings, shooting their mouth off about how we're going to rough the Russians up. I mean, it's just in history, I've never seen such bizarro behavior. It just smells of disaster and calamity to me, sir.
I have to agree with you. It's Alex, we are living in times that are unprecedented, and the peril that America faces right now is really almost unimaginable, because it's not just a full-scale economic collapse that we're facing. And it's not just the advent of a tyrannical government, which both in and of themselves are huge, huge threats. But we are also facing the threat of nuclear war. And in the modern context, that would be entail massive, massive loss of life. We would probably see an 80% die-off of population in our country, because even in a limited nuclear war, we would see our power grids brought down for an extended period of time. And that would, as I've mentioned in interviews with you before,
a chain reaction of biblical proportions with the reactors, the nuclear reactors, melting down within 4 weeks. And then you look at the spoiled population on average of the industrialized world not being self-sufficient. It is a true road scenario, a.k.a. Viggo Mortensen, a nightmare scenario. And what makes it worse is, we see the so-called elites accelerating their exit to faraway lands in the southern hemisphere, which is what you would do to avoid nuclear fallout, correct?
Right, exactly. Because the most people don't realize it, but the air circulation between the northern hemisphere and the southern hemisphere is broken up by the middle latitudes, and not too much air circulates across the equator. The southern hemisphere, in a most foreseeable nuclear exchanges, would be essentially untouched. So it comes as no great surprise that the power elites are heading for their hidey holes in the southern hemisphere.
I have children, and I'm so concerned, and my gut is concerned. Historically, we should all be concerned. The experts are all concerned. And I talk to young people especially, and they're so disconnected. They laugh at me and say, I like video games and comic books. I've had people to my face tell me that I'm a kook and that comic books are fun, and why don't I like comic books or you know, football games? And I'm just like, do you understand that the crazy political climate we see here now is just a local manifestation of what's happening worldwide? Double the number starving to death a year that were just dying, you know, 10 years ago. Plagues. Let me ask you this question. You heard me mention it earlier. We're going to go to break. CBS News with, you know, parents demand answers after Valley leprosy scare. And they go, well, there is some leprosy, but we're going to get the test back. I mean, there's just this laissez-faire attitude by the elites that are staying here while others evacuate. I mean, what do you make of just letting people in with TB, you name it?
Well, it shows the perversion of the system where politics are prevailing over common sense and good public health policy. And to think that for the sake of bringing in a few more potential Democrat voters, they're willing to admit a large number of refugees who test positive for not just tuberculosis, but for resistant strains of tuberculosis, which, as you mentioned before, are just about incurable. It's just almost unfathomable that public policy could be so perverted just for the sake of politics.
This is war. This is war against
the times we live in.
Is this not war?
Well, yeah. In effect, it is a genocide against the bedrock culture of our country. They're willing to sacrifice a good chunk of our population as pawns in this global chess game.
That's right. Stay there. James Wesley Rawls, survivalblog.com. I'm Alex Jones, Infowars.com. More straight ahead. We're just raising the alarm here. Let's look at some of the headlines at drudgereport.com before we go back to our guest, James Wesley Rawls. Again, if you're radio listeners, you just go to drudgereport.com. TV viewers, you can see us surfing right here. Confidence grows on the Hill as more of the Republican establishment now join Trump because they just know Hillary's collapsing. It's biblical how they have this fraud they plan to steal the election for, but God or time is catching up with Hillary. Poll, Trump now 19 points ahead of Hillary in the military. Folks, if you believe that he only has a 20% lead on Hillary in the military, I've got a bridge on the moon I want to sell you. 90% of the military supports Trump. I mean, it's probably higher. Fear of rigged election. Big reports there. Obama spends another $10 million to register new immigrant voters. Assange, Clinton bombshell, could drop next week. Hillary admits upping med load to combat coughing fits. So that's just some of the headlines that are at drudgereport.com. But I wanted to briefly go back into one of these because fear of a rigged election. I've got so many guests today. I hope we have time to play it. He just completed it. He was up most of the night putting it together because Rob likes to make these so powerful. But I shot a video yesterday where I break down the proof that the Democrats already stole the nomination, and they're planning to steal it from Trump, and now they're bringing multinational observers in and have the Justice Department saying they're going to be running all the key battleground states to ensure the Russians and Trump don't steal it. I mean, that's the biggest conspiracy theory in history, with no foundation. But remember a month ago when I raised this first, and that's what this video breaks down, this was insane. Obama said it didn't exist. It couldn't happen. But then, days later, they began to say, okay, we're going to have to federalize this. And here's Politico. Paperless voting could fuel rigged election claims. Amid Democratic fears of hackers, I thought the Democrats had no fears, and Trump's warnings about cheating, some key states will rely on electronic voting machines that lack a paper trail. So I thought when I raised this and asked Trump to raise this, and he did raise it 48 hours later, I thought that we were kooks. I mean, the media made a big deal of this, saying Jones says he talked to Trump and Trump did it his urging. I didn't say that. I've talked to Trump, and I said, you know, they tried to steal it from you. You fought and got it when the Republicans tried to take it. I mean, that's an admitted fact. And they stole it from Sanders. The Stanford Research Institute has come out and said, yes, Sanders was robbed. We've got to get ahead of this. I mean, this is an illegitimate candidate who stole the nomination. You should by default be elected. And Trump's like, yeah, I'm already on that. Exactly, yeah. It's like, hey, Trump, the sky's blue. Yeah, Alex, you're right. We're going to do something about it. Watch this week. And they try to, like, create some riff, like, Alex says he tells Trump what to do. Blah, 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 blah. I mean, it's just, it's the biggest baloney spewing system I've ever seen in my life. Meanwhile, Carville is freaking out, talking about fake votes and election chaos. The Democrats in 12 states have introduced bills. In Illinois, it passed the House, but it didn't get signed by the governor, to legalize illegal aliens. Here, one day, and you can vote. Talk about disregard for the sovereignty. Talk about arrogance. Talk about slapping us in the face with a rotten fish. Talk about just disdain and seeing what they can do. Look at this kook, this arrogant kook. Carville, possible to rig voting machines for 100 votes, calling election rigged, fundamental attack on our country, and then saying the Russians are coming to get us. When this guy, according to our sources, has rigged more elections than LBJ. And I love how he's got the Republican wife on the other side. I mean, I tell you, Jack Spratt could eat no fat. His wife could eat no lean. Between the two of them, they licked the platter clean. We're so sick of the Bush-Clinton dynasty. Just go away. Don't go away mad. Just go away. That's just some of the news there. If you go to Infowars.com, it is loaded with key information that the globalists absolutely do not want you to have. Just remember that. We are in a very, very serious situation. I reset my site here. We're in a very serious situation globally right now, domestically. We need people to be awake and sane and calling out the disconnected insanity of Hillary Clinton and others and Obama that reportedly watches ESPN like 8 hours a day when he's not playing golf. So go to Infowars.com. We've got massive coverage of what's unfolding. Illegals, quote, on video say Obama said it was okay to come. Hillary blames her brain injury on law breaking. We've got a bunch of other news. We've got Trump saying people who break up phones with hammers are covering something up. That's like saying 2 + 2 = 4. And they call that the kookiness of Trump stating the obvious. We're going to go back to our guest here in a moment and run through all these issues and where he sees this going in just a moment. But before I do that, September is preparedness month, and I promote and sell products that are the highest quality that I use, that I personally believe in, and that I feel really good about selling to you. It's called a 360 win, a term I coined. And we only do this once a year normally, but I've been doing it every few months now because we've gotten them to expand their production, you know, that they're literally packaging the food as soon as it's been, I've been prepared, super high quality, very, very low prices. Already a great deal on InfoWars Select, powered by My Patriot Supply. It's the exact same food. You can buy the My Patriot Supply full catalog right next to it at InfoWarsStore.com or InfoWarsSelect.com. But you get 30 to 40% off on InfoWarsSelect.com food for just this week. We're going to have to end it. We also have 20% off on a lot of other survival products like Nascent Iodine X2, Vitamin Mineral Fusion, Multivitamin, Fruit Punch Mix, and more. And while you're getting products you need, you're funding the information war to try to get more people awake and to try to hopefully fix this so you don't need to use these emergency products. But listen, with the glyphosate, the fluoride, and the bisphenol, and all the other crap in the water, thousands of different things. You're insane if you're not using an Alexa Pure Pro gravity-fed water system that blows away almost all the other competition. There's several other companies like Pro Pure and others that are excellent as well. They're all apples and oranges. We carry the three major brands of gravity-fed that in test are the best. Some are better at this, some are better at that, but they all reduce stuff down to 99% or more. You don't need this for preparedness, but we are discounting a lot of stuff right now during the sale. InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsLife.com is the nutraceuticals, the supplements, and your funding obviously helps us do what we're doing right now. We have the new BioTrue Selenium, the highest quality from mustard seed selenium. It's needed in all electrochemical activity in the body. It dovetails with the Survival Shield X2, True Nixon Iodine, and more. Going now back to James Wesley Rawls of survivalblog.com. He's a best-selling author of fiction and nonfiction. He's got a new novel out. We're going to talk about this series that almost seems prescient, Patriot series. We're going to talk about that in the last segment. We're going to break in about 8 minutes. But first, Mr. Rawls, giving you the floor again, kind of like we co-host here. I go 5-6 minutes, you go that long, because I want to let you be able to flow here. You heard that spectrum of news I flew out. You've got Hillary, you've got her open corruption, you've got the WikiLeaks, you've got all the looting of the government going on. We've got the Germans saying get ready for a giant emergency, Deutsche Bank teetering like Lehman Brothers. I mean, there's so many triggers here. What else should people be made aware of? A, spend 5 minutes on that, and then 4 or 5 minutes after that, sir, please, on silver linings here. I mean, are there ways to have a soft landing? Can cooler heads prevail? Again, I don't say the military and police are saints, but the reason George Soros wants a civil war with them, where we attack them, is because he sees them as number one enemy. How do we hopefully not have a military coup, but have a soft coup like we've already seen, where our military refuses to aid al-Qaeda and ISIS in Syria?
Well, Alex, I think the threats that we face are manifold, and you've detailed quite a few of them just in the last couple of minutes. But the important thing to keep in mind is that even with all these threats, I think there's still hope for our political process in the country. I think people ought to stay fully engaged politically. It's not time to go hide under a rock. It is time to speak up and wake people up between now and the election so that hopefully we can have an impact and stop the Hillary Clinton juggernaut. Without people alert and awake and fully engaged, we run the risk of just becoming the victims of our circumstances. So it's really important that people be fully engaged and fully aware of what's going on. And now is not the time to shirk, and now is not the time to cower. If you've been holding back on telling your friends, coworkers, fellow church congregants about the threats that we face, you need to stop. You need to actually speak up and warn people while we still have time. I think that InfoWars has been crucial in that process, and people need to carry through with that on a personal level, face-to-face with everyone that they know in their families, their coworkers, their church congregants, and so on, and neighbors. It's really, really important at this stage. I do think there is hope for the political process, and even though there's massive corruption and there's certainly some voter fraud that's going to go on, but if enough people wake up, they won't be able to.
You can't steal a landslide.
Exactly. You cannot stop a landslide once it's in process. And this all leads me to the next point, which is it's crucial, it's vitally important that we hedge our bets by having our families well prepared. I'm a big believer in homeschooling. I'm a big believer in food storage and all the other aspects of family preparedness. It's really important that people stock up, team up, and train up to be ready no matter what happens. It's every family's responsibility to look out for hearth and home, for their own family first, and then have extra on hand in storage to be able to help feed and house and clothe refugees, because there may be huge numbers of them in the near future, as I described in my novels.
And you're going to have to arm them and feed them to create your local defense force, or you'll be overrun and basically killed.
Right, right. So the crucial thing, though, it all comes down to calories. You need to stock up in bulk with all the basics, wheat, rice, beans, and you need to have good nutritional supplements to go with those, because when you're eating just bulk foods, all the really crucial little bits of nutrition may not be there. And the human body cannot just synthesize these things. You need to have those nutrients. And
I mean, I've gotten so concerned, I'm even stocking up on like antibiotics and other things. And again, because,
yeah.
I mean, it's always been a possibility. Last century, hundreds of millions were killed by government, World War II, World War I. But there's mm-hmm. not an amnesia. So many people have never lived through hardship. It seems like when we do have this fall that looks imminent, it just depends on how bad it's going to be, that it is going to be disastrous. I mean, can you imagine when we've got like 100 million people that can't even take care of themselves in this country? And we've got Latin America already collapsing. What does it look like? You've written books on it. In fact, you've written novels kind of wargaming all this out. Spend a few minutes on what this will look like if we're unable to avert it.
Well, if we can't avert a collapse, we could be in a situation where law and order breaks down and the power grids go down. As I mentioned before, there's three different power grids in our country, an eastern grid, a western intertie grid, and the Texas grid. And if any of the major grids go down, we could see a situation where the dependent classes of our society and those who have chronic medical conditions simply will not be able to cope. We have a society that has been not only dumbed down, but also so sissified that we really can't carry through as a nation with an extended power failure in this country. So many of our technologies, our transport, and our comforts depend upon the power grids. That if once the grids go down, the 18-wheel trucks are not going to stop, not going to be rolling any longer.
And it's
longer
all just on time. It's all shelves. It's all just on time delivery too. I mean,
exactly. Yes, we have Kanban just in time delivery systems. And we have so many things that are dependent on not just the power grids, but upon the internet for ordering products and stocking shelves. And we even have architecture in this country that is basically built around modern heating, ventilation, and air conditioning systems, where you have windows that don't open for ventilation, and you have a lot of buildings, a lot of the modern shopping buildings, like the big box stores, are big windowless concrete boxes. So if the power grid goes down, they won't be, even if they have the products, they won't be able to continue.
You couldn't come up with a program. Come up with a program to make us more dependent. And let's talk about the different military actuaries that are out there. I know there's historical lenses. Within 6-7 days, most people start robbing and killing with no food or water. Within 10 days, absolutely, almost everybody starts murdering and killing. And within about, 15 days, 90%+ become cannibals. So when the military, quote, trains to take on zombie waves, that's a cover for mowing down giant masses of people that will essentially act like zombies in a collapse.
Well, yeah, I hate to use the word zombie, but it's roughly analogous, because if you have this large dependent class of society that is completely unprepared and unable to cope, they are going to very quickly, as soon as they run out of water and no longer have a toilet that flushes and they're out of food, and most American families have less than 3 days worth of food.
And they have no morals, because in a moral society, and I'm not saying this, people commit suicide. In this, they're going to all be entitled. entitled to rape your wife, you name it. They're going to turn to total animals in minutes.
Right. It will be full-scale anarchy, and I don't mean it in the positive
way. No, it'll be road warrior. It'll be road warrior level.
Yes, exactly. And it'll happen much faster than most people think. So anyone who has plans to get out of Dodge to a well-stocked rural retreat, they better put that plan in. And
don't you really only have 24 hours? 24 hours, right?
Oh, certainly. Maybe less. Because once the majority of the population realizes what's going on, they're all going to hit the road. And a lot of the major freeways are just going to turn.
Sure. So really, you've got about 2 hours.
East of the Missouri.
5 days to a week before they start eating people. That's what all the studies show. It's happened in other countries. We'll be back. It's not Mission Impossible, but hopefully we can turn this thing around by educating enough people and get through their normalcy bias. The Commander-in-Chief Forum starts tonight, 7 o'clock Central. We're going to be carrying it live and giving minute-to-minute analysis of Hillary's BS. You know they're trying to hit Trump where they think he's strongest and weakest. That is, he's very popular with the military, but they want to claim because he's an outsider, he doesn't know how to run the military when Hillary runs all these failed states and is the creator of ISIS and Al-Qaeda. I'll tell you, the biggest thing I like about Trump is he's advised by General Flynn, who I know is a patriot. I'll just stop right there and help lead the military in not following Obama's orders to aid Al-Qaeda and ISIS. You heard Cy Hirsch come on, you know, 6 months ago and say InfoWars broke all that. I'm not bragging. I mean, we don't play games, folks. We have the real sources, the CIA whistleblowers, you name it. They go, well, why do they arrest other whistleblowers and not you? Because I'm too big a target, folks. They're not going to be able to get away with saying I'm a Russian agent like they do Assange. Okay? So everybody knows that is a pig that won't fly. They may try something else, but we are living in incredible times, to say the least. So 7 o'clock Central tonight, live coverage during it and then live analysis after. But notice Hillary can't even go in there but for 30 minutes and then have Matt Lauer, who works with her global initiative, ask the questions. So I would look for some dirty tricks, some really archaic stuff that nobody could really answer, like how many angels dance on the head of a pin, and then have Lauer go, answer the question, and try to stump Trump. And he should say, I don't know. Ask Hillary. It's in her emails. He's got to do something like that. And we've got him for 5 more minutes in the next hour, only 4 minutes left in this segment. And, of course, his website is pretty much the biggest survival blog out there, survivalblog.com, James Wesley Rawls. I want to spend a little bit of time in the next segment on your books, your latest novel. But first, just briefly, what other big issues are on your radar screen dealing with collapse? Because we're not fear-mongering when we say, look at Venezuela or look at all these other countries where it's already, the dogs and cats have disappeared for months off the streets. Now they're eating people. Now they're eating zoo animals. I mean, I don't think people understand how serious this is, A, and then B, why are we seeing global meltdown and societal collapse all over the planet, sir?
Well, I think Venezuela is a very good example of what can happen with a command-driven economy. And if Hillary Clinton gets into office, I think that's what she wants to try to create in this nation, is a command-driven economy. It's straight out of the socialist playbook. The threats that we face in terms of the economy are huge. We have a banking system and a stock market that are basically teetering on collapse. The bankers have taken the desperation move of going to negative interest rates. It's basically the last arrow left in their quiver. And they're basically forestalling a collapse at this point. I think they're trying to drag things on at least past the election in their hopes of getting Hillary Clinton into office. And at that point, they'll probably let things fall apart because they, under the Hegelian dialectic, can use that collapse as the excuse for creating a bigger government, a total government.
That's right.
That's the end game economically.
But nationalism is rising with the Brexit and what's happening here. That's really what they weren't counting on.
Yes, and in fact, that's the encouraging thing, is to see that there's some common sense out there. I was really glad to see the majority of Britons vote in favor of exiting the EU. And we have a hope of getting out of some of the multinational trade agreements that we've been locked into for so many years that have basically gutted our economy. They've gutted our manufacturing base and turned America into a banking and service economy, which it really never...
Which allows the globalists to control us. Again, they don't want anybody to be self-sufficient. Right. We'll be back in 70 seconds with five more minutes, then a raft of big guests and breaking news.
Thank you for listening.
Please tell everybody you know to tune in, folks. This is history. We got to stop this. We got to stop it. We can do it. We got to hit our knees, too. And what's scary is I've gotten to the point where I want to just drop everything and go get ready with my family. And I'm not saying that for effect. I mean, I really am just totally honest with you. Everybody knows I'm sincere. It's all I got is my sincerity. As obnoxious as it is sometimes. And talking to James Wesley Rawls, who I was reading his books, oh, I mean, I don't know, 18, 19 years ago. And just thinking, oh, you know, that is a worst-case scenario. And now a lot of the scenarios in his earlier novels are like good scenarios. We have a big UN takeover. We're physically fighting them. That's a hell of a lot better than a nuclear war. James, in closing, talk about your novels. Talk about if we're unable to turn things around, where we're going. Because, I mean, I think that's really a testament here with the persecution of Christians you've written about and the rest of it is, I'm not looking for trouble, but defensively, I'm going to stand up for my family.
Well, I think, and that certainly is, you're right. It's everyone's right, and we need to recognize that the way our nation was structured under the Constitution, that check of the Second Amendment is kind of the last resort, but it's the last means we have for reinstituting constitutional government. And I think as we see a collapse, as I described in my novels, we may see a opportunity to reinstitute constitutional government only through asserting our Second Amendment rights and exercising those rights. It may come down to that. So please, folks, don't give up your guns no matter what happens. And stock up, team up, and train up. It's what I describe in my novels. I've completed my Patriots novel series, that five novel series, and I'm now embarking on a new series. It's called the Counter Caliphate Chronicles. It's also set in the near future, and it describes a world that's under the domination of a global caliphate and the establishment of Christian homeland nations to counter that. And again, I use my novels as a teaching tool to try to describe what people should be looking for, ways that countermeasures that they should be taking to counter the threats that are the many threats that are out there. My novels are essentially survival manuals dressed as fiction, I guess is the best way to describe them. And folks, even for those who don't have the opportunity to pick up any of my novels, please at least go to my website, check out survivalblog.com. All the content that's there is free of charge. It's fully searchable, and the archives now go back 10 years. There's tens of thousands of articles.
And let me just throw this in, sir. Why is it, because you've been a New York Times bestseller, why is it people will read something if it's fiction and it's really a manual? Because I realized that years later reading your stuff, like, this guy's really warning us and getting us ready for, you know, this is how to resist militarily, but not calling it that at a guerrilla level. Why do people like fiction versus, you know, the real deal?
Yeah, a lot of people won't sit down and read a 300-page survival manual. But if you have a real page-turning novel, people will sit down and read that. And with novels of my sort, I'm not the only one in the genre now. It's now become a very crowded genre.
But you pretty much started the genre.
Yeah, I think so. But what I try to do is try to squeeze a lot of practical, tactical tips into a fictional storyline so people end up reading the novel twice, the first time through for entertainment and the second time.
That's right. Well, come back sooner. You're a hard guy to get on. Come back on soon. You're a hard guy to get on. James Wesley Rawls, thank you so much, sir.
Well, thank you so much for having me on, and I pray for you and all your listeners.
You too, sir. God bless. I was thinking last week about the film Kill the Messenger with Gary Webb. I interviewed Gary Webb a few times, but I talked to him a lot more on the phone because he wanted me to help him build a website. And he wanted to help me launch his book exposing the fact that he had been right about CIA drug dealing. which they even had congressional hearings about, admitted, not just in the 80s, but the Army bringing heroin in from the Golden Triangle. And then look at what's happened in Afghanistan. I mean, it's a known fact that criminal elements of our government bring the drugs in. They even make movies about it. Sicario. It's actually based on true stories where they got the Delta Force down there running the whole thing in South Texas right now. But Freeway Rick Ross, some people say, well, what are you doing having this guy on? One of the biggest cocaine dealers in history. He was working for the CIA. Once he knew about it, he exposed it. They threw his butt in prison. He's a hero for exposing it and not being a coward and being the star witness for Gary Webb. So, you know, none of us are perfect in our lives, but he joins us just for the next 20 minutes or so via video link. And we've also got his famous message to Rick Ross, the fake Rick Ross that took his identity, the rapper, the former jail guard, and his message to the CIA when he was here with us last year. We're going to repost that to Infowars.com. But FreewayRickRoss.com is the website. He spent, what was it, 15 years in prison. He talked to Gary Webb right at the same time I was talking to him because he was, you know, his star witness. And Webb was getting his new book out. He had to move. Guys kept breaking in his house. They stole his motorcycle. That's all in the movie. That's why I was like, got nauseous during the movie because the actor looked like Rick Ross and I's friend, the award-winning reporter. And it was just so accurate. And then I was thinking last week, I had to get Rick Ross back on. He's been in studio before, but also a guest many times, including from prison. We got exclusives with him, both video and audio over the years, about Hillary and the minimum sentencing, where basically if you're drinking a Coors Light that white people tend to drink, you get probation. But if you're drinking Slitz malt liquor, you get 10 years. You're smoking crack, you get 10 years, you get probation if you're snorting it, which is what rich people do. It's more of a class thing than even race, in my view. But the point is, she's the lady that said blacks are super predators, bring them to heel. Well, there they are at MENA, and I've interviewed all the top people that were there at MENA who saw the cocaine being unloaded. Terry Reid, you name it. Just to see her up there. So I don't know his view on Donald Trump. I didn't call him before this interview. I don't know where he's going with this. I just know that he's an informed person, and to me, to see her playing the race card, knowing how heavily she was involved with the Bushes and the CIA and this whole thing in MENA with the cocaine, I wanted to get Rick Ross's take on this, the real Rick Ross, freewayrickross.com. And so thank you so much for coming on with us today, sir. What's your view on all this?
Well, you know, it's funny that you asked me about that because I was in prison when the Clintons implemented a lot of their laws, and I can remember the effects of the laws, and mainly the 2255. I mean, that was like really a devastating blow to not only blacks in prison, but pretty much everybody in prison, because what that did was you had 2 years to come up with an issue that would prove your innocence. And if you didn't do it within 2 years, if you came up with it later on in life, say, for instance, if you found the person that actually committed a crime that they accused you of, well, you had no way of bringing it to the court's attention.
It's incredible. So what is your view of the Clintons? I mean, it's known they were involved in all this. You go to prison, $25 million a day sometimes of cocaine you were moving. She ends up becoming queen of the world. I mean, what is your view of her, of Trump? I mean, I know it's a lot to ask you to wade into, but as somebody, you know, at the center of this and this minimum sentencing, what's your view on that, Freeway Rick Ross?
Well, you know, I never did politics before in my life, and I just recently started paying attention to politics. And so it's funny that you called me about politics, and this may be the first year that I ever vote. And I am watching the debates, the news, and just getting a feel of it, and hoping that whoever gets in realize that the country has made a great mistake with the way they've treated their and I won't say inmates, because we're not really inmates. We're really brothers, sisters, uncles, fathers. I mean, we're humans just like anybody else, and we've all made mistakes. And for anybody to look at us and want to throw away the key, and then even after you go and do, I did 20 years in jail, by the way. I know you said 15, but I did 20 years in like two.
I'm sorry, I know it was like 15 and then another sentence. I don't know where I got the idea of 15. I apologize.
Okay, it's okay, Alex. You got a lot on your plate.
We just lost his Skype right there. It'll come right back up. It was breaking up a bit. The reason I wanted to get him on is this is somebody at the center of CIA drug dealing and a guy that they were basically going to let off if he wouldn't talk to Webb. And he won't hoot his horn. I actually admire the guy. He has a lot of courage. His Skype just came back up. Please continue with what you were breaking down. What I'm trying to get at here is that the people that killed Gary Webb are the very people in power right now. Hands down, there's no debating that. And so, in general, I'm not trying to get you to score some point against Hillary Clinton. I'm just saying, sitting back, knowing Hillary Clinton's history, I know you know about Amina, Arkansas, and the rest of it. Just what's your gut reaction to that?
Well, it's funny that, like I said, that you asked me to come on and speak on this, because it's really a touchy situation. You know, the black community was hit really hard with the crack epidemic from both sides. You know, from people getting hooked on crack, and from so many people going to jail. And I've heard Bill say that he made a mistake and changing those laws and being so harsh on guys involved in drugs.
When he, by the way, is a giant cocaine dealer and cocaine user on record. I mean, I don't get how, like, the governor in New York is banging hookers every night and he passes a law to take John's cars. I don't get how Clinton's snorting, smoking cocaine. He's reportedly smokes it. And then he's going to put people in jail that do it. I just don't get it.
Yeah, well, you know, it's a double standard, though. If you have, then you don't have to go to prison. And if you have not, then...
Well, I'm sorry. If I was a governor and I was banging hookers every night, I'm not going to pass laws to take John's cars. I just don't get these guys.
Well, they feel like they're different than us, though. They make the laws and they don't have to abide by them. So you know, you can break the law, you can lie, you can cheat, you can, bang whoever you want to. They're not going to take your car. You know, you're the governor. So if you pass a law, it doesn't affect you and it doesn't affect your family. So... just go along with it. And I believe that this is the way that this system has been going, that these people are so out of touch with everyday people like me and yourself. You know, you walk on the streets every day. These people never walk on the streets. You know, they got 20 or 30 people with them when they walk down the street, so they feel like they're above the law.
I agree. And that's the theme of the show today, without us even trying, is that they're above the law. They're on a cloud city. They're in an ivory tower. George Sr. doesn't know how to use a scanner to, buy food. Hillary's in another world. The press corps can't have press conferences. They ride on oranges and roll them to her.
So I'm hoping, what I'm hoping out of this election is that, for one, I've been telling, blacks all along is that they need to hold their vote for who's going to support them. And not just blacks, but everybody as a people. We need to make sure that whoever we put in the office, it's not going to be banging John's, like you said, and then locking other people up, for being a John.
Not a hypocrite. Overall, we've seen black unemployment basically double, worse than ever, under Obama. He hardly ever visits those communities. I think he thinks he's already got it, in the bag. Why does he need it? I mean, what do you make of Trump? I mean, Trump has spoken to dozens and dozens of black churches. ABC News said this was the first one last week. I went and looked it up, total lie. He's been going to prayer vigils, you name it, totally reaching out. He's on record. He's gotten awards from Jesse Jackson and the NAACP for hiring African-Americans. He's gotten awards from the gay community for calling for tolerance, but then they say he's anti-gay. I mean, I think the media has really distorted who Donald Trump is.
Yeah, well, and that's one thing. I don't really know much about Donald. I read a couple of his books while I was in prison. And I have implemented of some of his strategies. I did learn some strategies from him. But what I see in the news is not very much in supportive of minorities or blacks in particular.
Sure.
Our unemployment rate is at an all-time high. And here where I'm at in South Central, I'm living in South Central still. Most blacks would work well under the minimum wage, and we have the stereotype that we're lazy and don't want to work. Well, I see it totally different. I see it that people don't want to hire us and don't want to give us a chance.
Well, undoubtedly that's going on, and that's part of this cycle where you put people in prison for petty offenses, and then when they get out in 4 years, they have a degree in being a criminal, and then you can't get a job. It's not rocket science.
And you also have the notch on the box saying that you're a convicted felon.
I tell you, Freeway Rick Ross, I didn't get you on today to sit here and endorse Trump. I held my nose over a year ago to support him, but I'm proud of the fact I am now. After the whole power structure from the Chinese communist president to you name it, I absolutely hate his guts because he's for sovereignty and truly bringing wealth back to this country, which can be done very, very easily. They've sold American wealth out to build a world government, but it's not too late to turn that around. And I know that Trump talks about law and order, but he is for a lot of decriminalization. I think that's very positive. But separately from that, what was it like? Because we've talked to you since it came out, but to see Kill the Messenger and how well that was done and how accurate that was, I mean, in your own words, to be living a surreal movie that was actually reality. And now, you know, 20 years ago when the series first came out, he got attacked for it, or 19 years ago. Now, it's just admitted that the big banks are the really ones shipping in the drugs.
Yeah, well, I'm hoping that one day Gary will get his just due. It's sad that we run such a well-rounded and investigative reporter, and you know, hopefully people will recognize the work that he did, because a lot of the stuff that he did back then is what people are using right now to be educated.
Now, he told me, talking about you, because I know he was working trying to get you out of prison, he talked about how, I know you want to talk about yourself, he talked about how much courage you had, and the story's so long and complex, I get a lot of it wrong, but explain to me, you had chances to shut up and get out a lot earlier. I mean, I was told just a few years in you could have gotten out, but you didn't. That's why I think you're a hero, even though you don't want to be told that. But you speak to kids around the country about staying clean and how the drug war is bad and all the rest of it, but why did you? Because I got to be honest. I'm not going to sit here and sell out on air. I'm not going to sell anybody out. But if I was locked up, it'd be hard not to say, okay, I'll keep my mouth shut. Let me out of here. I mean, I'm just being honest. I mean, how the hell did you do that and stay in there 20 years?
Well, you know what? It was something that had to be done. The people had to know. And I felt if Gary was willing, Gary had absolutely nothing to do with any of this. Nothing. But he put his life on the line to write this story. For me and my people and my friends, so I felt that I had to stand behind it as well. And a lot of people think that I'm the one who created the CIA thing, but Gary came to me with the story. I didn't go to him. I was glad that he came, though.
Absolutely. And to be clear, you didn't even know you were working for the CIA until you learned it.
I didn't know anything about... You know, Alex, I was totally illiterate when I went to prison. So watching the news and reading the newspapers, those weren't things that I kept up with. I didn't keep up with the CIA. I didn't keep up with Congress. Like I said, this will probably be the first year that...
No, you were keeping up with like $100 million a week in drug money.
Exactly. So I was totally a novice to any of this information or to... what was going on in our country until Gary Webb brought it to my attention.
And you spent 20 years for the truth, and he got his head blown off, two shots to the head. God rest his soul, but he's an icon of journalism and the truth. We see this war on the press today. It just shows us how far this has gone. In the 5 minutes we've got left with you, looking at just the climate of politics in this country, the CIA has stolen the identity of this great country and these other corrupt offshore corporate interests that run it. But you saw Rick Ross, you know, the big fat fake rapper who was a jail guard who lived in the system preying on black people. And I'm sorry, I don't have a bone to pick with Rick Ross. He's just such a coward. You called him out. Millions of people saw the video, and the video just cut out. We're going to Skype reconnected. And, you know, his response was to just make jokes about it. But man, I tell you, I don't know how he calls himself Freeway Rick Ross and everybody thinks he's you. What is that like to see Rick Ross still out there with your identity and then his thugs kind of making threats like we're scared?
Well, you know, it's another part of this because it's not just him, Alex. It's the companies that's behind him, the billion-dollar
companies. Of course, they obviously told him to do all that.
that's pushing him. So to know that these people don't mind feeding us rhetoric is really bizarre. It's hard for me to believe that companies so powerful and that could have so much positive influence on our people would be willing to feed them the same stuff that got me involved in drugs. You know, it was a movie that planted the seed in my mind to want to be a drug dealer.
You're talking about product placement, propaganda placement, preconditioning. What's the proper term that we normally use to actually call it? There's a name, predictive programming. Absolutely. They sell it like it's cool, and then you're bad because you went out and followed what they told you was the American dream.
Exactly. And you hit the nail right on the head with that one. Also, you know, too, I didn't tell you, the documentary Freeway Cracking the System is nominated for an Emmy this month. So hopefully...
That was my next question. A lot of TV shows, a lot of movies being made about you, a lot of awards. Tell us about the documentary. Tell us about the things going on at your website, freewayrickross.com.
Well, you know, that's a new website where I'll be selling my books and my shirts and all my merchandise. They can go on there. Also, they can leave me messages. They can talk to me and so forth. The documentary won't be on there for sale yet. We're going through a legal battle. You know, they didn't want me to be a producer on the documentary, even though I produced it.
Well, that stuff always goes on. People ought to just get out the way. Get out the way of the real Rick Ross, because I got to tell you, my daughter loves the purple shirt you gave me. She wears it as like a nightgown. The real Rick Ross is not a rapper. And she just loves the whole story, how that big fat Rick Ross is not the real Rick Ross. I mean, I don't even have a dog in this fight, but the guy is such a fake. I mean, remember his early story was he was you.
Exactly.
I don't get how you steal somebody's identity and make $100 million, and then the real Rick Ross, I just don't get it. It's just crazy.
Well, you know what? You've always been a genuine dude, so you couldn't understand that. It's hard for people who are genuine to understand why somebody would even want to steal somebody else's identity. Why not make your name and your own reputation and be who you are?
Well, I got to tell you, I was giving out one of the newer sites. The official site is freewayrickross.com. Is that right?
That's correct.
freewayrickross.com for the book, the t-shirts, and to support what you're doing. And the reason I really support what you're doing is not just the courage you had to end up going to prison because you told the truth. That's on record. And now a major motion picture that's won all these awards documents it. It's the fact that you go all over the country to major high schools, colleges, dozens of times a year, educating young people and telling them to stay off drugs.
Absolutely. I wish I could do more. But, you know, a lot of schools still don't accept me in because of my past. You know, once you get that past, you kind of stuck with it. You know, you can never not be a convicted felon. I would never in my life be for the rest of my life, I'll always be a convicted felon. You know, there's no thing in our system that says, you know what, this guy's been out. I've been out almost 8 years now, and there's no way that I can take that off my record. I'll always be.
And by the way, the third time's the charm at your website, right? It's Freeway Ricky with a Y, Ross.com, freewayrickyross.com, and we'll link it up on Infowars.com. Let's talk soon, my friend, or anytime you're back in Texas. Freeway Rick Ross, God bless you. Be safe.
All right, thanks.
He's got courage, folks. Stayed in prison an extra decade plus because he wouldn't back off about the CIA. We'll be back.
We're on the march.
Tons of news. Stay with
the
us.
Empire.
Let me reset here and get serious. This video is encoding right now. It'll be up on YouTube and Facebook in the next hour or so, and I really wanted to have it up this morning so we get a maximum push. It's so darn important. But I'm going to have a few of the writers write articles about it today and tomorrow so that hopefully it gets a push. And hopefully you will think it's important and you will send it out on your email list, post it to your Twitter, your Facebook, put it out on your local radio station, because there was election fraud early on. There has been election fraud, and now they're trying to steal the election now. And you notice it's gone from being no issue, a zero on the Richter scale, to a 10. It's gone from zero to stratospheric in the last 4.5 weeks because I came down here on a Saturday with Rob Jacobson and shot the video. And you got the video out. And Donald Trump responded, and the public responded. I I've had the press call him and say, did you tell Donald Trump that? He did come out word for word. Say what you, yes, I talked to Donald Trump, but that doesn't matter. It's about the election. And it's about responding. Trump knows what's going on. We just put out well-produced, factoid-laced, chopped full of documentation videos that prove what's going on. The New World Order is absolutely out of control. It isn't controlling itself. It sold world government as a plan to end war, end poverty, and build us a palace to the stars. Instead, they used it to screw job everybody and pull up the ladders of success and create unmitigated hell, which they've now packaged into this cosmology of austere living and being poor and how cool it is, while the priests of this religion lecture us from red carpet podiums sitting next to palaces and jumbo jets. It isn't flying. The dog isn't hunting. So this report is going to go up on Infowars.com. It's very important. I don't know what we call it. Obama admits Donald Trump is right about election fraud, or this video will stop 2016 election fraud if you spread it. I mean, I don't know. Here's the point. We get lightning in a bottle all the time. Whenever I have the tumblers click in my brain and I figure something out and I act on it, it's always important. It's always world-changing. It's always big. Not just because of Alex Jones, because of you and Matt Drudge and so many others. All I know is this video is important. This information is important. They're bringing foreign governments in to run our elections because of the deadly danger of election fraud, which they say didn't exist 5 weeks ago. The president and Hillary are having to attack me by name now because we're hurting them. You're hurting them. And to quote an amazing thespian Shakespearean actor, Ricardo Montalban, when he played Khan in The Wrath of Khan in the 1980s, he said, I'm hurting you, and I'm going to go on hurting you. So run as fast as you can. You'll never escape. Except this isn't a movie where you do escape. You will not escape. Let's go ahead and play the special report. Barack Hussein Obama and Hillary Rodham Clinton are in total panic. They've been forced to admit that Donald J. Trump is right about systemic election fraud.
Can you promise the American people that this election will be conducted in a fair way?
First of all, it's rigged. And I'm afraid the election's going to be rigged, I have to be honest.
Of course the elections will not be rigged. What does that mean?
Russian hackers were behind two recent attempts to breach state voter registration systems.
Good to see you in this exercise in transparency and democracy.
The FBI has issued an advisory that urges the states to look for specific signs that could indicate attempts at similar cyber attacks.
But I want to tell you again, I don't know anything about it. And on the state level, Russia has never done this.
Multiple senior government officials tell NBC News they are now confident Russian intelligence was behind the DNC hack, although they lack definitive proof.
They lack definitive proof, definitive proof, definitive proof.
Our whistleblowers go to significant efforts to get us material and often very significant risks. As a 27-year-old, I worked for the DNC, who was shot in the back, murdered.
Is that what it is?
If we see signs that a voting machine or system is vulnerable to hacking, then we inform those local authorities who are running the elections that they need to be careful.
Some short-term, long-term things I think that we should do to bolster the cybersecurity around the election process. I am considering communicating with election officials across the country about best practices.
But of most concern, of course, are the separate computer systems that count and report actual votes. So far, no sign that any of those have been compromised.
This black box is unaccountable, untestable, privately run software from the two companies that you have hired to count our votes. So when votes come out of this black box, they do not reflect the New York City or the national votes. In 22 primaries, the votes have shifted in 20 of them. The exit polling data in New York State shifted 12%. A shift of 2% is fraud, according to the U.S. State Department. So that's what we've seen across the country.
The Russians, and do I think they're trying to help Trump? That's the point. Are they, right?
Russia has denied any involvement in the attacks on the U.S., and President Putin called the accusations an attempt to distract the public's attention.
It doesn't even matter who hacked this data from the campaign headquarters of Mrs. Clinton. The important thing is the content that was given to the public.
A little over a month ago, on July 30th, I pointed out the elephant in the room. Sanders. Mr. Trump, I'm not going to lay things out here that you don't already know. But I am going to ask you to seriously think about making the issue of Hillary's election fraud in the primaries one of the central issues to defeating her in November. We had just witnessed Hillary Clinton steal the nomination from Bernie Sanders. Now Stanford University's done their own study, has concurred with our analysis. We'd seen the Republican Party try to steal the nomination from Donald Trump by claiming that popular vote never counted.
The media has created the perception that the voters will decide the nomination, and that's the content, that's the conflict here.
We feel like we live in a democratic society. What you're telling me is it's not a democratic society, and your votes don't necessarily matter because it's a democratic representation, correct?
No, that's not what I'm trying to tell you. What I'm trying to say is that we're just one of the political parties. There's many political parties, but political parties choose their nominee, not the general public.
George Will even wrote an editorial for the Washington Post saying, your mere plurality of votes doesn't override the party's sovereignty. InfoWars issued an emergency message to Donald Trump, and within 48 hours, he responded.
First of all, it's rigged. And I'm afraid the election's going to be rigged, I have to be honest.
Why would you think that the election would be rigged?
Well, I'm looking at all of these decisions coming on down from the standpoint of identification, voter ID. And I'm saying, what do you mean? You don't have to have voter ID to now go in and vote? And it's a little bit scary. And I've heard a lot of bad things. I must say, 4 years ago, I was hearing a lot of bad things having to do with the Romney campaign where... when the vote came out, there were some districts who were really shockingly different from what they were anticipated to be. And I've been seeing it.
Within days of Donald Trump warning the people of the United States of the ongoing plot to steal the general election, Barack Obama went public and said that it was preposterous, ridiculous. In fact, he didn't even know what election fraud was.
I don't even really know where to start on answering this question. Of course the elections will not be rigged. What does that mean? The federal government doesn't run the election process. States and cities and communities all across the country, they're the ones who set up the voting systems and the voting booths. And if Mr. Trump is suggesting that there is a conspiracy theory that is being propagated across the country, including in places like Texas, where typically it's not Democrats who are in charge of voting booths, that's ridiculous. That doesn't make any sense. And I don't think anybody would take that seriously.
Now the Washington Post, the New York Times, USA Today, Politico, you name it, are coming out and saying, we are so threatened by supposed Russian hackers in the database. And the Russian government runs Trump and they run Alex Jones and they run Paul Joseph Watson. Why Putin runs everything and they're dangerous and we need to send Homeland Security in to take control of the elections to make sure they're not stolen from Hillary Rodham Clinton.
What I can say more broadly for the administration is that they're
has been a discussion about whether or not to designate certain voting systems that are, of course, maintained at the state and local level as pieces of critical infrastructure. And that would give the federal government and experts of the federal government.
But within weeks of Trump's announcement that he would be sending out observers to make sure our elections weren't fraudulent, Obama did a 180. He hired the UN and he hired the security agency of the European Union, the OSCE, to come into the United States with Justice Department power and take over the elections to make sure that they were protected and had integrity.
The federal government doesn't run the election process. States and cities and communities all across the country, they're the ones who set up the voting systems and the voting booths. And if Mr. Trump is suggesting that there is a conspiracy theory that is being propagated across the country, including in places like Texas, where typically it's not Democrats who are in charge of voting booths, that's ridiculous. That doesn't make any sense. And I don't think anybody would take that seriously.
The truth is the Democratic Party in Illinois and California and many other states were openly pushing to let illegal aliens actually vote in the 2016 election. And Donald Trump and others are aware of that fact. And so they were calling to have local governments be involved in the integrity of the election process. So what did the feds do? They announced all these foreign observers were to come over, but they were going to then restrict domestic independent groups from poll watching. So what they're saying is, we'll let foreigners come in and watch from the socialist EU, but we won't let Americans oversee the elections internally. Look at this headline. Election security, federal help or power grab? Some state election officials say officers to aid the fight against hackers could lead to Washington taking greater control. And that's what Roger Stone said months ago on my radio show. He said, look, it'll be the feds coming in to oversee the elections that steal it. USA Today had the headline, Homeland Security can't step in to protect the election. The Examiner reported, Homeland eyes special declaration to take charge of elections. Here's the facts. The Russians have a GDP the same size as Italy. They're not influencing the United States in any way that's even measurable. The globalists have conquered this country. They've taken it over by stealth. They've captured our nation by fraud. And they are so scared that nationalists, just like the nationalists we saw in the UK that voted for the Brexit, are now actually communicating with the people through the new independent media. That's why they're calling for internet censorship. That's why they're calling for internet IDs. That's why they're calling for actually shutting down Matt Drudge and sites like DrudgeReport.com and Infowars.com, because they can't compete with the facts. They can't compete with the information. And they know we're not going to stand by and watch them steal the election like they tried to do with the primaries. And so they're claiming we're Russian agents. The truth is, we're agents of an open and truly free society and a republic where it's one person, one vote, no matter what race, color, or creed you are, as long as you bleed red blood and are American. And the truth is, Donald Trump and countless others are mobilizing private, independent poll watchers that are going to expose the fraud. And it's got the power structure really shaken up. They thought they'd just come in and steal this general election like they stole the primary for Bernie Sanders. They thought they'd do it in the dark when none of us were watching. The truth is, we're watching. So now they're doubling down, bringing in the EU, the UN, and all these Democrat-run feds to save the integrity of it when they were just telling us a month ago that there was total integrity and nothing to worry about. They're panicking because they know humanity is on the march and their oppressive empire of tyranny is on the run. 2016 is a crossroads. It's one of the most important times in humanity's history. And you better believe the entire crew and the listeners and viewers of InfoWars are going to be there on the right side of history, defending open free societies and our right to vote and this constitutional republic that is known as the United States of America. We truly premiered that here because a lot of times I'll premiere something but have it go simultaneously up on Infowars.com. Do added so many clips, so many documentation to that, that we're a little late getting out, which is fine. You did a great job. It's not on Infowars.com yet. It's not on PrisonPlanet.com yet. It'll be up there in the next 30 minutes or so. And I'm just asking every viewer, every listener, I know you already know all this. You saw us warn back at the time. You're aware of it. You've got the research. But your neighbors, your friends, your family aren't. Now, what really happened here? The truth is the Trump campaign was already aware of all this. So I don't want to say they did it because I told them to, but it certainly added to the impetus. And Trump told me, no, I'm going to be covering this the next few days already. So we're just on the same page, basically. But where they didn't go, where I advised them to, is, hey, you stole it from Bernie Sanders. So you're illegitimate. Now, I can't stop you in the party from you being the fraudulent nominee, but don't try to steal it from me. And then that gets all the Sanders people on your side. They want to just leave the steal back there at Philadelphia, have you move on to the next issue. That's how globalism works. Always the latest problem, the latest distraction, the latest smoke and mirrors, the latest, you know, funhouse garbage. No, we have a memory, and it's congruent with reality. And so we're back to the future, or back to the past, and back to the future again. Because, as I told Trump and as I told his campaign people, and I said, look, I know you're smart, I know you get all this, but justice is what's in order here. I know nobody's ever done something like this. They've never openly stolen a nomination like this. And I know it's bold to say they stole it, but they did. It's admitted. So you've got to expose it's fraudulent, raise that issue. It's the right thing to do. It makes people worry about election fraud in the future, which makes it harder, puts a spotlight on it, gets more poll watchers, gets more media aware of it, which is what the system didn't want. They said, oh, it's totally has total integrity. What's election fraud? Because they were going to go steal it with no coverage, basically in the dark. No, you're going to do it at high noon now. We're firing the flares in the air. But bigger than that, it then gets all the Sanders people to not just forget what just happened to them, and it makes it a political issue of voting integrity. So you say, hey, you may not agree with everything Trump says or whatever, you still vote for him because at least he was actually nominated by the people. And you win the election by 20 points. I mean, Hillary might have had 20% of the Democratic votes. We did exit polls around the country from Texas to California to New York to Florida. And, I mean, it would be 80% for Sanders on Election Day, 90% for Sanders coming out of the booths. Outside, I'm for Sanders. And then you go turn the TV on, and it's Hillary by this landslide. And then they're so arrogant, they admit in newspapers, oh, the delegates, the superdelegates, decided the night before that it would be Hillary. So you stole all these major primaries. Oh, yeah, Stanford University says so, too. Big deal. Move on. I'm not going to move on just because you play some little flim-flam game with me. And again, I was like 4 years old at a school function, and my dad, some preschool thing, and they had a magician come with a table and a rabbit, and my dad was whispering in my ear, and he goes, son, that's a box, and they reach down through a trap door and pull a rabbit up into the hat. That's why it's a tall top hat. Now watch, and I got it, that it was a fraud. And it wasn't that my dad was stealing magic from me. That wasn't magic. My parents having me or you, that's magic. Or this planet and where we are in space and what we've done together is magic. Or Beethoven is magic. Not some carnival trick. And my dad was so proud of me when I was one of my earliest memories, like 2.5 years old at Christmas. And we were there in that little three-bedroom house in Dallas by White Rock Lake on San Fernando Way. And my earliest memories and the neighbors are over and families and everything went, no, Santa Claus comes down the fireplace. And it was a big crackling fire in the Christmas tree. And I said, but he'd burn. Plus, he's fat. This is a little house. This is a little chimney. Oh, he's magic. And I said, no. And I remember, like, the cracks in the bricks, the mortar. And I said, no, he's too fat to go down that. And my dad looked at me and he said, son, I'm so proud of you. There aren't any 2.5-year-olds that know Santa Claus isn't real. We got big hopes for you. And I'm not bragging. It's just that I didn't believe in Santa Claus at 2.5, and nobody had to tell me. And I don't believe in the New World Order either. I believe in you. And I believe what we're going to do together. I'm going to go ahead and host the whole next hour with Devin Knight because we had to push Stone forward. And then we've got this other demonstration I'm going to do. Have you heard they got to roll oranges at Hillary? That's how they do. I'm not kidding. That's how they do press conferences. I tell people this. They go, are you joking? No. She doesn't have press conferences. They roll oranges down the jet. And then if she wants to answer the question with like one word, like, would you rather interview Trump or Putin? Talk to, and she goes, oh, I'd rather talk to Putin. I mean, this is real. In fact, people won't believe me. You guys print some articles. I saw it on the news this morning. It's crazy. Hillary's been doing this for years, but you roll oranges at her. So we're going to have Leanne in here rolling oranges at me. Journalist asked Hillary Clinton question by rolling an orange. And they said, well, this is a customary. This is how she does a press conference. I mean, talk about fruit baggery and all these weirdo Nelly crones that want to start all these wars. I mean, it's just like, it was like some 6'5" badass general with 2 Congressional Medal of Honors. You know, I'd still say don't start a war. But I'd listen to them a lot quicker than I'd listen to, like, stumbling, jittering idiots. September is preparedness month. Now is the best time ever. 30 to 40% off of storable food, X2, a bunch of big discounts, InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsLife.com, and your purchases make it all possible. Thank you for your support. Fourth hour starts in 70 seconds. This of course, under Common Core, 2 plus 2 can equal anything, so maybe it starts in 87 million years. I don't know, but according to common sense, 70 seconds. We got some big, big political announcements here. Gubernatorial run stuff, you name it. We've got a lot of other things we're going to be breaking here today, obviously, on InfoWars.com. David Knight, some of the news you've got there, built up there in the hopper. I want to get into some of that, but briefly, it's incredible how they said there's no election fraud. It doesn't exist. Hillary, like, saying, what's turkey? I cook turkeys at Christmas. When they ask about the Turkish ambassador in Benghazi, they really think we're that stupid. And I guess some people are that stupid, but now they're panicking, saying the Russians are hacking. The elections are in trouble. If Trump wins, the Russians stole it. We're sending in Homeland Security to hook computers up to the battleground state computers to make sure the truth happens. It seems like they've walked right into our trap, David. We've got him in the other studio. In fact, I'd be happy to have him in this studio because today we're going to be co-hosting together. We can always do that.
Alex.
Yeah. Tell us your view on that, David.
I was looking at the transcript of the speech that Donald Trump gave today in Philadelphia. Of course, he gave a speech on national security last night. He was in Virginia Beach. He also went to North Carolina yesterday because, of course, both of those states have a heavy military presence, large military bases in those areas. They're swing states. He gave an amazing speech in Philadelphia. And, of course, tonight, when we're going to cover it live on the nightly news, he's got a joint forum, and the topic is going to be the military and national security. He had a great line, Alex. He said when he got onto cybersecurity, he goes, Hillary Clinton has taught us all about the need for cybersecurity. some great lines in the speech. But he had some great policies as well. Now, he's talking about building up the size of the military. And when I look at that, that concerns me. But his focus was on peace through strength.
And jobs.
Exactly. And what
we're not going to have billion-dollar fighters that don't work.
Mm-hmm. And the concern that I have when we talk about building up the military is the adventurism, okay, the imperialism, the overthrowing of nations. And he really hammered Obama and Clinton for doing that. So that's a good sign. It's a good sign that Paul Wolfowitz has trashed him, of course, the architect of the Iraq War and other.
Sure, the neocons hate him. Yes. Look, they get the fact that we have to have peace through strength. We've built up the Chinese. Yeah. They've run our military out. Our military is meant to collapse at the moment world government begins. Trump gets the whole double cross. He's advised by Patriot generals that get it. He's about to double cross them, and yeah. So are we.
Yeah, absolutely. And he got about, it was 88 former generals and admirals who endorsed Trump yesterday. So he's coming in with about a 15-point lead amongst veterans. And Hillary had a very, very weak response to it yesterday.
And let's talk about this, though. Let's talk about this, because you know what they're going to do. His strong suit is the military loves him.
Yeah.
But they see it as weak because he doesn't know all the little BS factoids. I guarantee you we're going to have one of those things where Matt Lauer, who works for the Clintons, ask him some weird factoid that nobody knows the answer to and tries to keep saying, you don't know the answer. You don't know the answer.
Yeah.
And I'll say, no, I don't know the answer to your little setup, but answer me. Where are the 33,000 emails?
Yeah, he's going to ask him if we should invade Harambe or something like that, right? You know, the gorilla. Okay. Thinking that.
Exactly. I guarantee you it's going to be some. Look, that's why they're walking him into a stage debate tonight.
Yeah.
This is going to be the attempted assassination politically of Trump. Don't you just see it happening?
Well, the other thing they're going to do, Alex, besides the gotcha on trivial details, they're going to also try to come after him for pushing back against Sharia Khan and against John McCain. And that's what
I would double down and say, yeah. It turns out these people are worse than I even said.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, when we look at this whole situation, every time I see it reported by the mainstream press, they say he attacked a Gold Star family. Well, you know what? This guy, you know, he is somebody who, if the military is out there fighting for our freedoms, fighting for the Constitution.
And this guy's pushing something that overrides it.
Yeah, that would be repulsed by a guy who is supporting a theocracy based on Sharia law. That's amazing. Why wouldn't Hillary be called on to denounce this guy instead of having multiple Sharia people on the
instead,
stage?
Instead, she's got Mateen, the gay mass shooter's dad, creeping around behind her.
Exactly.
These people are just buckets of treason. But the good news is God is taking the very words and breath out of Hillary. I mean, she looks like the walking dead. And there's a lot going on in this universe. It isn't just in those books. We'll be back. Julian Assange told Fox News last night that he's got thousands of the deleted emails, as we knew he had, with Hillary knowingly signing off on the secret documents and basically trading in them for favors. This is more devastating than anything we've seen yet, and there's even more coming. The big question is, what type of scams are they going to run to try to divert from this? There is so much Trump news. We have Roger Stone, who is particularly spiffily dressed today, joining us, and he's got big breaking news coming up in about 5-6 minutes that deals with the state of New Jersey. But first, wow. I tell you, Hillary having five-minute coughing fits. Then when she calls it a conspiracy theory, she has a coughing fit. A fake press conference, coughing fits. They're rolling oranges at her now to answer questions. This has entered Caligula-level bizarro-ness. Marie Antoinette on steroids. I mean, I just sense collapse and failure. And I love the smell of victory for Donald Trump in the morning. Brexit, too. What do you say, my friend?
It's an exciting time to be alive, Alex. I agree with virtually everything you just said. Trump is on the upswing here. CNN poll showing him leading by one. Geez, that wasn't supposed to happen. Hillary gets miffed when asked about it. Continuing stories about her health based on our observations. They attacked both you and I last week by name, claiming that it was a vast right-wing conspiracy. No, we can see. The woman's not well. It's obvious in her scheduling and her coughing fits and her falling down and her needing help up the steps.
And the EpiPen and the WikiLeaks where she wants Parkinson's medication.
You know, as we have said on this program, I think Julian Assange may have the keys to this race. Remember that in the Clinton Foundation scandals, the Clintons' defense has always been, you have no proof. Not, we didn't do it, but you have no proof. I mean, yes. We took millions from a Russian conglomerate, in essence, that wanted control of uranium production in this country, and we gave it to them, but you can't prove that those are related incidents. Well, perhaps Mr. Assange can prove that. Then you have Trump's incursion into the inner cities, talking about what the policies of the Democratic Party have done for Black Americans and for our cities. And I hear that there may be similar trips in Baltimore, in Los Angeles, and other urban areas that are dying under the policies of the Obama administration. You have the warm-up for the debates. And, Alex, I think the most important issue, which you put on the griddle, well, things get so bad that it only increases the chances that the Clintons will engage in both voter fraud and elections.
That was my first question for you, but I wanted you to have the out of the gates first issue. Whoa. I mean, they go from saying it doesn't exist 4.5 weeks ago, I'm insane. That's that crazy Texan. when they just stole the nomination from Sanders to now, oh my God, the Russians, it's total fraud. Trump's working for Putin. Alex Jones, Roger Stone, they're evil. We've got to bring in foreign observers, all hands on deck. I mean, they did, I guess, want us to be able to point out fraud if they tried to pull it. So now they want to be the guardians of the election when they do try to steal it. It seems like a major blunder for them. Am I wrong?
Yeah, no, I think you're right. Look, as I said on this very show, watch the watchers.
You said it a month before they did it.
This will be done. So, look, I've never touched a nerve with the political establishment in almost 40 years of being active in American politics, like anything like the piece I wrote for The Hill, in which I cited the Stanford study that indicates that Hillary rigged the election against
Trump. They went completely ape over, talk about Streisand effect. I mean, that story was big, but it wasn't getting huge attention until they flipped out.
And then I cited the Princeton professor, Professor Appel, who shows that these machines can be easily hacked. I highlighted Dr. Bob Fitrakis from Ohio State Community College, a political science professor, his excellent work showing the hacking of these machines, the CBS video, and good God, the running dog lackeys of the Clintons, the Soros-funded Media Matters for America, and their so-called Correct the Record, which ought to be called Distort the Record, went insane.
So their entire narrative is imploding. Hillary is emblematic.
The Hill should block Roger Stone. C-SPAN shouldn't even talk. We should block discussion of the potential.
So what does this signify? What does this signify? They tried to shut down discussion of election fraud and voter fraud. Now it's front and center. Where do they go from here?
And they see Donald Trump gaining. And they see him making incursions into Democratic turf. Therefore, their panic gets greater. And their attacks on us become more shrill and more personal. Alex Jones isn't running for president. Roger Stone is not running for president. Hillary Clinton is going to have to try to divert from the avalanche of bad news she has coming. I predict to you, Alex, here and now, that the Haiti scandal will blow even further open.
For those that don't know, she stole almost all the money.
Well, working closely with the Bushes, I think they stole their half all as well. And the entire backstory of our actions in Libya, which have resulted in the putting women in Libya back 200 years to medieval times under Sharia law. And Black Lives Matter, unless you live in Libya, in which case Hillary Clinton bombs you and has to go to the national credit card to borrow the money to do so. So we can get rid of Gaddafi, a guy who has renounced his nuclear ambitions, who's sharing his intelligence.
Sure, so what would you do tonight if you're Trump? He only has 30 minutes. They're going to be attacking him. They obviously want to make him look like the gotcha moment. What do you predict about tonight?
Look, Trump is he's very good on his feet. Remember, he didn't come to politics from the world of politics and elective office. He came to politics as a celebrity on the world stage. Who handles himself very well when the camera's on. I'm not worried about his ability to handle her. He knows the book on her inside and out. The more he reads, you can read it in Clinton Cash, you can read it in my book, The Clinton's War on Women, you can read it in Dr. Jerome Corsi's new book. It's all there. This is the news about the Clintons that was suppressed in the 80s. And now you've got the breaking scandals. In the failures of the Obama administration, Trump goes into debate.
Hillary looks so shook up. I know we have a big announcement we're about to make. Hillary looks so, we've got plenty of time here. We can go over. We need to. I'm going to skip this break. Hillary looks so shook up right now, totally freaked out. Assange has given us hints how the media is being run by her, how she's got thousands of emails she's claimed she didn't have that are marked secret. He said that's coming out in the next week. And then even more, we can think about what those tidbits are, but we already learned that she's advising the Chinese president for money and from other world leaders. I mean, this lady is a whore politically.
Yeah, no, look, she's not a liberal. She's not a progressive. She's a crony capitalist. It's all about the money. It's always been about the money. Everything was for sale. Look, Bill Clinton, without any question, and I wrote it for InfoWars, Bill Clinton traded military secrets, missile technology secrets, to the Chinese in return for Chinese funny money, Chinese campaign contributions that were laundered. That's treason. The statutes for treason have no statute of limitations, and the penalty for conviction for treason
death
is execution or incarceration. So it's all back on the table. They're the ones who decided to get
well,
back.
Well, I'm not just saying this, and I know you're an eternal pessimist or realist, but I sense defeat of the globalists, defeat of the Clintons. I mean, I think, and I know there's still 60 days to go or 59 days, but I sense panic in their ranks. And so let me ask you this, and then we'll go to our special guest you brought us. What on earth do you expect them to strike back with? I mean, this is a wounded lion or goblin creature. Roger Stone of the StoneColdTruth.com, what do we look for?
Yeah, this is kind of ironic, Alex, because the problem is that they're already rolling out their old playbook and it's not working. Look, we'll just decimate Trump as a racist, as a bigot, as a misogynist. He's trigger happy. He's crazy. It worked on Barry Goldwater, but that was a long time ago. And it's not working, and that's what's making the
panic. Yeah, this is not 1963.
Number one. And number two, I mean, look, I really get tired of this. They continually attack me as a racist. I marched with Al Sharpton in favor of the reform of New York State's racist, draconian Rockefeller drug laws. I raised money for the campaign to reform that law, while the spokeswoman who calls me a racist for Hillary Clinton was not even in diapers. So calling Trump a racist is part and parcel, and it's not working. And the
well, it's like we go out to this gay pride parade, they're screaming, Donald Trump hates us, he's horrible, and the guy was an advocate before anybody was. It's just these people are almost so dumb, they almost don't deserve Donald Trump.
No, look, I had Chris Barron, who's a very articulate gay community and Republican activist in Washington on my radio show, Stone Cold Truth, last week, and he outlined the case for gay people in the post-gay marriage era, where that decision is at least currently a decided matter, one that I support, by the way, because I'm a libertarian. And therefore, I think gay voters are starting to shift to their personal safety after the horrific Orlando killings, and who will protect them from Islamic terrorists. And then, secondarily, they're looking at economic prosperity.
Come on, Hillary coughing and hacking and stumbling around is emblematic of a collapsed society. Now, you're giving us a big announcement today. It's been hinted at for a while, but very exciting. I always enjoy seeing this individual, you know, out there speaking out. And I have to tell you, if Al Franken can be in the Senate, this guy does need to be governor. Tell us the next shoe to drop there in your famous activities, Roger Stone, in the great state of New Jersey.
Well, you know, I always thought that Ronald Reagan, and to a certain extent Donald Trump, being people who came from outside the confines of career politicians, brought a certain celebrity status to their candidacies, and therefore that celebrity status allowed them to be listened to where they could make the case for their ideas. And yesterday on Fox with Neil Cavuto, my friend Joe Piscopo, the Saturday Night Live veteran, who's now a very hot radio talk show host, and who's gotten more and more outspoken about how he sees the political system being dysfunctional, he told Cavuto that he was going to seriously consider a race for governor of New Jersey next year, most likely as an independent. I had lunch with Joe today, and he really has not only a very good grasp on the issues, but he has no ties to the failed policies of the past. He has no investment in the Republicans or the Democrats. He lives in one of the most dysfunctional, high-tax states in the country. And he told me today at lunch he's going to make a serious consideration of the race. He's going to look at all the factors, but that everywhere he goes across New Jersey, Alex, people tell him that he should run for governor, that he should clean up the state. And it started with one or two. He now tells me everywhere he goes, he hears it. At first he was flattered, but kind of thought, well, I'm an
I always like seeing him on TV when he talks on the news about issues. He seems like a really smart guy. And I might have got my wires crossed, but is he at your place right now?
I have dragged him with me, and he is very anxious to talk to you about what's on his mind.
All right, well, let's bring Joe Piscopo, who I always love on Saturday Night Live, and I love seeing him on Fox, you name it. I hope he does run for governor. Now, Joe, you've teased us before in 2004, so let's bring Joe in here. Into the screenshot there. In fact, you guys can sit in your lap if you want. The time I had Christopher Walken on, he actually sat in the fellow's lap. Hey, there you are, buddy. You look sharp.
How are you? Yeah, man, you know what? Hanging out with Roger Stone. This is wild. It's like a museum around here. I got Nixon posters. I got Reagan posters. It's wild.
Wow. Talk about the state of this country. So I hope you're running for governor. I mean, is this the big announcement right now, or are you just going to tease us?
No, you know what? I got to look into it. I've been on Neil Cavuto's show. Neil's been pushing me on Fox, you know, to go in. And then, like Roger said, I just kind of went on the radio, and we started talking about it. And on Neil's show, people are saying, you got to do it. You got to come in. You got to run, because everybody's so fed up with the system, the rigged system indeed. You know, and you know what? I'm a lifelong Blue Dog Democrat, Alex. And I just left the party a couple of years ago. And I'm not a Republican. You know, I'm a diehard independent. You know, I believe in America first. I honestly believe in that. And I think people are hearing that. And they just want the system reset. And they feel a guy from the outside, like old Jersey Joe here, can do it.
I got to tell you, I've always been a libertarian and didn't like the Republicans either. But I got to tell you, the Democrats have taken America-hating, out-to-get-us, bizarre behavior, working with ISIS, you name it, to a whole new level. And I think Trump's taking over the Republican Party. I don't even see him as a Republican. I see him as a populist. So maybe running for an independent might be good for you, but getting with Stone over there, he's a smart guy in New Jersey, obviously. They say he's the best in New Jersey. Maybe run as a Republican. I mean, take over the party, my friend.
You know what? That's an interesting... Can I steal that idea, Roger, from Alex? Can we do that? Jerry, say he's going like this. Yeah, we can maybe do that. But you know what's upsetting as a Democrat? I got to tell you, I sit before you as the spokesperson for the Boys and Girls Clubs of New Jersey. My heart goes out to at-risk kids, because they were, for the grace of God, go I. Go all of us, man. And I see in the eyes of these children myself when I was a kid. So now you look at Chicago. Alex, 500 people, 2016, killed in the streets of Chicago. That's the Democrats allowing that to happen. And it happens in New Jersey, you know? And it's so unsettling when I walk the streets, man. And I walk the streets in the inner cities and I see the upset. And then who do we turn to go to the inner cities? It's Donald Trump. I've been railing on that on my radio show for the last 3 years about that. About getting a Republican, you know, or somebody in that, you know, arena to go to the inner cities, and it's Donald Trump. So it is time to take it back.
That's right. Joe Piscopo's our guest. Your audio is pretty good, my friend, but as a radio guy, if you can a little bit forward, it might be a bit better. What made you leave the Democratic Party, and what's got you to the point, Jarvis is a successful guy in your life, to want to get in this arena of politics? It's obviously not for fame and fortune, but because you're concerned.
Well, you know, I got a lot of kids. In New Jersey, I have a child at every exit. And I tell you, I love kids. I'm a dedicated father. The taxes are insane in New Jersey. I can't pay any more taxes, man. I think the IRS is a criminal organization. And then I saw how the Democrats are really deserting the inner cities and not helping out these kids like they should be. And I'm telling you, it's the Democratic Party. I'm an old JFK Democrat, Alex. I was for years. You know, my family came from another country. They learned the language and the laws of the United States of America. They learned how to become an American. They didn't come here and say, you got to learn our laws. You know, we're from another country, and if you don't learn our laws, then we're going to kill you. We came and we learned how to be Americans, you know, and that was the old Democratic mantra. It's not like that anymore, man. And the Republicans aren't like that either.
Well, by the way, I would vote for a JFK. Absolutely. It's like, how do the Democrats turn into this? I mean, let's be honest.
Yeah, that's a great question. I don't know. It could be the enabling. It could be maybe, you know what, and I try to be nice because I don't want to be vicious. I don't want to be hateful. But maybe it was all with good intentions that the Democrats came in and they came in and they started saying, well, we need to help out. And they tried to reach out in so many ways with entitlement programs. And now it's just gotten completely out of control. And I don't understand the global nature of everything now. I mean, this whole TPP deal. President Obama's over on the Pacific Rim. What's he doing in the Pacific Rim? Come to Camden, New Jersey. Come to Paterson, New Jersey. Go to Elizabeth, New Jersey.
That's what I don't get, is that he got like 95% of the African-American vote, and he's visited less black communities than any president before him. It's like he just almost just pimps them, doesn't even care.
You know what, Alex, don't get me started, because with respect to the Office of the Presidency of the United States, President Obama has it in the palm of his hand to change this whole inner city structure. And he could do it. He could go on a tent. Rather than going to Martha's Vineyard, rather than going to Laos, he should go to Chicago, he should go to Ferguson, he should go to Baltimore. They should do a tour, and he should take he should take somebody with him, you know, in the celebrity arena to go around. And really, it's going to take, like what Donald Trump is talking about in the inner cities, it's going to take 10, 20 years to turn it around. But don't we owe that to the citizens of the United States of America? We're going to bring in tens of thousands of refugees from terror nations. We don't know what they're going to do when they come in here. Why don't we help our fellow citizens?
I agree. And by the way, they called it a flip-flop. It's when I finally went from liking Trump to loving Trump. Because he goes, oh, the poor Christians being murdered. We've got to bring them all in. And they went, sir, they're bringing in 0.3% Christians when they're 20% of the population. They're bringing in an unvetted, they're mainly Wahhabists that invaded. He goes, well, we got to stop bringing them in until we vet them. Then they spend that. That wasn't a flip-flop. As he got more info, he immediately changed what he was saying. That's what we're looking for.
I know. Alex, you're right on the money. I got to tell you, I've known Donald Trump for 20-something years. In good times, you know, and I'm an entertainer, man. You have good times.
Yeah,
bad.
Spend a minute or two on Trump. I mean, I know because you guys have been friends. I mean, what? How would you crystallize who Trump is?
He's a good guy. He's a regular, down-to-earth guy. He's a very humble guy. I remember seeing him. We go to charity events. He's always giving to charity. That's what how I know him most of all, is going to charity events. I remember going to Atlantic City where you take a downturn in your career, as every entertainer does. Lord knows I've had those downturns. Donald Trump was always there. You want a hotel room? Go, come here. Go. You want to come stay at the hotel where I come in? Always remembering, always a good guy, never forgetting his friends. This is a decent human being. And I'm telling you, when you see the bluster, you see the buttons pushed, you know, it's not really Donald. I just think he's a master marketer that is, he is a step above and ahead of everybody else. But I'm telling you, the Donald Trump I know is a decent guy, a regular.
Can you imagine how great it'd be to have him as president to negotiate and stuff compared to Hillary?
No, listen, man, I got to tell you, I'm pumped up on this too. On my radio show, and if I can plug it, Alex.
Please.
We're on AM 970, The Answer in New York, you know, right on, and you can get it online, am970theanswer.com. It is time for a reset. It is just time to go out of the box. I don't hate Hillary. I want to put all the hate aside.
But she does look like a corpse. I mean, what do you mean? I mean, the coughing fits. You couldn't host your show with those coughing fits. How could she be the president of the United States?
I sent a note to her recently. I sent a note to one of her key guys to get her one of those cough drops. I have cough drops that could help that with that. I don't know how she doesn't know that. But that aside, she is the machine. That's all the machine. Talk about rig, man. Talk what they did to Bernie Sanders. You know, whether you like Bernie, whether he's a socialist, like him because he's a socialist or not, the guy was organic. It was organic politics on the left. And it's very, Donald Trump is very much the same way. It's organic politics. Don't give me the machine. We are so tired of the machine. And when people come to me, Alex, and they go, hey, man, you got to run. You got to run. Get in the office. It's taking it back.
Joe, I know you got to go. Speak of the devil and do your own show. Joe Piscopo is our guest. 3-minute break. Come back. Say bye. I'll say bye to Roger. We've got our next guest coming on. The show's almost over 25 minutes. But Joe Piscopo is our guest. We're going to pop back in 3 minutes. All right. If you are a radio listener, we've got something coming up very special in a few minutes after Joe Piscopo leaves us with Roger Stone. Leanne McAdoo, one of our star reporters, is going to roll me oranges. And then that's how I answer questions. Hillary won't have a press conference. She tried to have one and had to stop it because of hacking fits. But you're allowed to roll her oranges. And I came in and told the crew this a few days ago as I'd heard about it and again today. And they go, that's not true, until I pulled the articles up. Joe Piscopo, this is, I mean, I know we're not bashing Hillary here. Obviously, we never do that. But the new level of weird, as a comedian, who the hell makes up, like, you don't ask the emperor questions. You roll them oranges.
I know. You can't make it up, man. You know, I come into the radio studio every morning. You know, we do 6 to 9 East Coast every morning. And, Alex, you can't make it up, man. You know? It's like, even whether it's about what's happening with Hillary and how they take the narrative on the news, the mainstream media takes the narrative on the news, and everything's bad about Donald. They'll say something bad about Donald. Then they have to do an FCC equal time. But what they do is they'll go to, like, somebody, Tim Kaine, and they'll say, well, and Tim Kaine will say something bad about Donald Trump. It's like they think we're stupid. I think they think we're stupid. You can't make it up. It's an exciting time to be on radio, though, man. Because, again, you can't make it up, and it's just time to take it back.
JoePiscopo.com. I'd hope to get you back up in the future. Always love your comedy. Love the movies you're in. Love seeing you on Fox. Getting back to, because I want you to be able to finish as we hit the break,
yes,
about something outside the machine. A reset, something new. I would love to have a female president. I could care less if they had great ideas. I mean, it's just emblematic how sick she is, the corruption, the lies, the WikiLeaks. I think the establishment better watch their butt, pull back, and let Trump get in there and then try to blame their mess on him. If I was them, that's their only hope. I think they try to steal this from Trump. They got big problems.
Alex, they're scared. They're scared. The lobbyists and the lawyers and everybody down in Washington is so scared. They're running for the hills. Nothing more. And I'm speaking on behalf of a lot of people who listen to my radio show. We just need that reset. It is our time. And if you don't take it back now, I got news for you. We ain't going to get it back. It's going to slip away. The tenor and the character of the United States of America is going to go away. It is our time. This is our time. And you can't stay home. I want to put a bumper sticker up, a hashtag, don't stay home. When November 8th, you got to get out.
Well, I think you just said it then. You've got to run for governor now then. I think you just said it. You are running for governor, Joe Piscopo.
If you say so, man, I'll listen to Roger and see what he says. But listen, I appreciate, respect, and love so much the great state of New Jersey. And we are in a bit of disarray. The taxes are out of control, and there's a lot of folks that need help there.
Brother, they claim Texas, my beloved state, been here for nine generations, founders of the state. They say we're one of the best states in the country. You drive around, it looks like a war zone outside nicer cities. I mean, it's falling apart, too. If we're doing great, I can't imagine what New Jersey's like.
Yeah, no, you know what? There's hope there. I just don't like
I like New Jersey. I've been to New Jersey. Some nice beaches.
It's beautiful. That's right. The Jersey Shore, where I live out in the boondocks out there, you know, and all those Italians, you know, I'm an Italian-American. I'm a proud Italian-American. But we got to bring the jobs back. You cannot let the jobs go away to the Pacific Rim. You got to bring the jobs back. That's so important. You could make just simple jobs in the inner city.
Our politicians made money off selling our jobs. Folks don't get it. They wrote bills where you can't compete in this country. Joe Piscopo, I hope you're running for governor. I mean, what I heard is basically you were a little in before, but what are you, 90% there? I mean, when will we know whether you're going to run for governor or not?
Yeah, a little while. I'm like, Roger's like giving me hand signals. I'll let you know. You know what? You'll be one of the first to know, Alex, you know, but I'm just listening to everybody right now. But it's still a year and a half away, so I got
to. Well, you got to start riding that wave. AM970theanswer.com for your radio show. Thank you so much, Joe. Look forward to talking to you again, my friend.
God bless you, Alex. Thanks, man.
It was a nice surprise. All right, we're going to get. It was a big surprise to have Joe Piscopo on, but I'm going to be honest. The time that Christopher Walken had another guest on, Christopher Walken wanted to be on the show. Christopher Walken came in and sat down on the guest's lap. That was a little bit weirder. That was Belzer. We need to get him back on. The Twilight Zone continues. We have one of the most famous confidants of Richard Nixon now joining us, who, again, he admits was corrupt, but my God, compared to Hillary, seems like an angel. What would Richard Nixon think of this debacle of debacles we're witnessing?
Let me tell you something, Alex. When it comes to corruption, Richard Nixon, Hillary Clinton makes Richard Nixon look like St. Thomas Aquinas. what was one of the counts of impeachment against Nixon? He abused the IRS and used it against his political enemies. Yet three of the women sexually assaulted by Bill Clinton get IRS audits, and no liberal says a word. By the way, I suspect there's more, and we'll probably learn about that before Election Day. But Alex, I want to salute you because you've had the courage to take on the whole question of both voter fraud, that is people ineligible to vote, phony voters, dead voters, voting multiple times, and the separate but related issue of machine rigging. Now, you have all these technical experts and all these political science professors and all these experts telling us that rigging these machines is a simple, quick, easy matter. We know that a $15 device you can buy at Radio Shack or Best Buy allows you to vote multiple times. So a group of activists, in my case, who support Donald Trump, and also friends of mine who are in the Jill Stein and Gary Johnson camps, and I do have friends in both the Green and Libertarian Party, who just want an honest election. We have been looking at how to stop the steal. And as you know, there's a couple ways. We've talked about scientifically conducted exit polls that would allow us to compare the results on a precinct by precinct basis with the actual results to see if we can find a pattern of fraud. I'm also intrigued by the whole notion that the setup for the steal are the rigged polls. So the polls they inflate the Democratic sample to increase Hillary's lead, or in some cases to create a lead. And then they rig the machines, augmented by voter fraud, to approximate the results of the poll.
It's a self-fulfilling prophecy, but now that we're calling it, what do they do? And when I ask you, you're always very accurate from what I've seen with internal polls. Trump seems to be surging ahead of her right now. A lot of the models show him winning in a landslide, or is that a pipe dream?
Well, I think it's a little premature, but he's having a very good week. His speeches have been excellent. He's demonstrating discipline on the stump.
Total genius going to Mexico. Total genius going to Louisiana, acting presidential. Why didn't Hillary do that? It seems like she's totally blind.
Well, she must be too ill to travel that far. Look, here's the point. I have been talking to Dr. Richard Davis, who has an excellent program called OLMO, which would create a multi-million voter national sample, a sample that is too large to be wrong. And I'm going to be working with Dr. Davis, who's a very impressive fellow, to help implement a program so that we can debunk the phony polls.
I think you're right. Next is debunk the polls. But let's just take the big aggregator sites, the social networks. They go off massive samples. They say Trump's landslide. That's what every aggregate shows. That's what all the it shows, that the activity for Trump is 3-4 times just in activity positively what it is for Hillary. I mean, that's the real bellwether here.
Well, I think to a certain extent that that people don't recognize that in many ways the polls are a precursor to movement. The movement now is with Trump. Hillary's static. Trump is on the move. And the direction of the poll is more important than the current total because, frankly, the moment a poll is taken, it is technically outdated.
No, I get it. But clearly the fortunes have turned massively for Trump. Look for dirty tricks. Look for assassination attempts on Hillary. My God, the sky's the limit. We've got one final question with David Knight, who's co-hosting with me, Mr. Stone, and we're going to let you go because I know you're busy and need to see Mr. Piscopo out. Thanks for bringing him on the show today as a surprise.
And I have one key point that I need to make at the very end here,
Alex. Sure. Well, go ahead and make that point and bring David Knight in.
Sure. Look, last week the mainstream media attacked me, saying that the entire question of Hillary's health was a right-wing conspiracy.
And I have a dark heart.
Here's my response, and it's very, very good news for the people at Ricola and Luden's and Smith Brothers. Folks, mail your cough drops to Hillary Clinton at Hillary Clinton for President, 1 Pierpont Plaza, Brooklyn, New York, 11120. Send her your cough drops, because from what I can see, she needs them.
I agree. Ricola! Again, let's give out our address. I agree. We should mail the press. We should mail the White House. We should mail everyone cough drops. That's a great idea. Roger Stone, give out that address one more time.
You can mail them to Hillary Clinton at 1 Pierpont Plaza, Brooklyn, New York, 11120. And I'm sure the Clinton campaign will announce how many cough drops they receive from the kind, benevolent citizens of the United States.
Probably needs them. Let me ask one more question.
Sure.
I mean, you were on this 3 weeks ago, the conspiracy theory, the ridiculousness of the Russians. And I was like, okay, Roger, yeah. But now they've gone, you're right, totally crazy. We're all Russian agents. Trump's a Russian agent. No, the whole world hates Hillary. Everyone's sick of her. She really seems to have screwed up, that they're going to take control of the elections because of the Russians. I mean, this is laughable.
Well, and now we have a new backstory. That yes, they're concerned about election rigging, too. But they're concerned that the Russians are going to rig our elections. They call us conspiracy theorists? That's accusing Donald Trump of treason. Donald Trump is a man who loves...
Meanwhile, you said it was coming out. Even the New York Times had to admit that it's actually the Ukrainian crazy right-wingers run by Soros that are actually involved in our election illegally.
Yeah, this is a terrific piece of the Financial Times that outlined how Viktor Pinchuk, with his agent in the United States, Doug Schoen, longtime Clinton intimate, are interfering in our elections. To the extent that there is any foreign interference in our elections, Alex, it's coming from Hillary's friends in Ukraine.
Incredible. David Knight, you were chomping at the bit. Come in here.
You know, Alex, we've got this article that's up on the Drudge Report about Carville talking about how, you can't rig the elections. Maybe you'll get 100 votes here and 100 votes there. And, of course, Roger Stone, if people don't know, they can tell people about what happened in Chicago with the JFK-Nixon election or in Florida with the Bush-Gore election. If that were true, if you could only rig 100 of them here and there, that would be enough to rig the election in a close election. But it's extensible, Alex. If you admit that the electronic voting machines can be rigged, and one voting machine can be rigged, 10,000 voting machines, 100,000 voting machines can be rigged. And we need to understand that the largest electronic voting machine company, Smartmatic, came from Venezuela. It was created by cronies of Hugo Chavez, and it has connections to the Soros Open Society Foundation.
It's ridiculous.
It's what we're seeing here, Alex. They want to talk about the Russians rigging the election. Let's talk about the Venezuelans rigging the election. What we saw in Brazil was a situation where the woman who's just been impeached for corruption, those corruption charges were already known when she ran for re-election 2 years ago. She was behind 10 points in the poll. She was being booed in a soccer stadium of 60,000 people, and yet she won. Okay, this was just before the election.
We have massive fraud. That's a great point. Yeah. Final comment. We're bringing Leanne McAdoo in here. Leanne McAdoo is about to do something with us, but Roger Stone, final comments. We're going to let you go on that.
I think David hit a very key point. See, James Carville is trying to confuse people between voter fraud and election theft. These are two completely different issues. Carville, there's some validity to what he says. It's not hundreds, but it's thousands. Voter fraud does not exist, as the left says. It exists. It is somewhat more limited. But election theft through the machines makes it
an obvious. It's bipartisan, and they keep trying to confuse the situation. Roger, we'll talk to you again soon. Come on anytime you want, my friend. StoneColdTruth.com. We'll talk to you soon.
Help us in the struggle. Go to StopTheSteal.org. We're not going to sit down and just let
this. That's right. We're organizing to fight it. That's why they're so scared. And you can also get the Bill Clinton rape shirt at InfoWarsStore.com. Thank you, Roger.
Thank you.
Now, continuing on, we're going to skip this network break because this is so important. Leanne McAdoo, ladies and gentlemen, if you're a radio listener, you should definitely be tuning in at InfoWars.com/show to see the oranges. No, you have oranges right here. Let's go to Leanne McAdoo. Leanne McAdoo. Now, this is a serious news story. If you're a new listener, a new viewer, the media thinks you're so dumb, they'll probably play this on TV, like on Jimmy Kimmel, and say that we made this up. But no, it's in the news that you don't get to ask Hillary questions. She hasn't had a press conference in 270-plus days. She tried to have a fake one with five or six reporters on the plane. Couldn't talk because of the coughing fit, because she's totally well. But you roll her oranges down the jet. And then if she wants, the newest question was, would you rather talk to Putin or Trump? And she said, Putin. And then she said she didn't really even circle that. But this is the thing, I guess it's on the campaign trail the last year with Hillary, something they do. So,
well, it's a traditional thing. Apparently it started with Reagan. I have literally never heard of this orange rolling question thing until now. And it's like the press must feel like total idiots, because I cannot even explain to you how difficult it is to write in Sharpie on an orange. So not only does she not hold press conferences with them, but then she makes them write in Sharpie on an orange and then go.
Talk about royalty, though. Just imagine if I said, I don't talk to you.
Right.
They say, don't look at Hillary in the eyes. I roll oranges.
And then if she decides to. So here I've got a.
By the way, where are you?
This is a pressing question.
Can you hand me the carrots under the table, please? Because in a minute, everybody's going to find out why I have a chicken.
And why do you have
also some Jimmy Dean? Where is that?
Why do you have all these bizarre props? That's what I want to know.
I mean, because they've gotten this weird. I'm only reporting on the news here. You didn't get Jimmy Dean? Okay, well, okay.
We are missing the Jimmy Dean crisis.
Oh, yeah, we have it. We have it. Okay. All right, sorry. Leanne, go ahead.
Okay, well, we have some very important questions here.
You're not allowed to talk to me. I'm so royal. I'm like Hillary, so this is normal.
Well, this is our one opportunity. We're having this press conference. It's our one shot, and so the American people really want to know.
Okay, from now on, talk to me only about oranges. Do you like oranges, yes or no? Okay. I guess get a Sharpie here. Here we go. I have a Sharpie. Okay, and the answer is yes. So that's how we hold press conferences now. Of course, if you stay.
Well, you have to roll it back so
I'm sorry.
It's not
okay. Official. Here you go. Then I can deny I did it if I want to answer the question differently. Thank you, Jimmy Dean. All right. Thank you. All right. What brand of hammer? Oh, earlier we have the video. Can we play that when Hillary has her employees hammering phones when they come under subpoena?
Yeah, and CNN, in the midst of a panel explaining how she used a hammer at the State Department to destroy. They said, wait a minute, stop. We need to fact check that on the fly.
Ah.
I want to eat that orange after.
Look at this. Ah. I'm sorry. I'm tagging. Anyways, all right. I'm sorry. I'm going to stop now.
Tens of thousands of dollars.
People know it's Eastwig. SureStrike.
SureStrike.
When you've got to destroy documents or phones, quickly use a SureStrike. Okay, Leanne, here we go. This is press conference. This is an InfoWars press conference. Is the election rigged? Yeah, they're going to try to. They wanted to deny it. We forced it out there. Trump forced it out there. You, the viewers, forced it out there. Now they're in a conniption fit with the UN and EU coming in to run our elections. Leanne McAdoo, can you make up information of this magnitude? Let's see if I can hit that camera over there. Hi-ya! Oh, there we go. All right. Leanne.
Let's see. We already answered.
TV viewers are getting much better here.
Oof.
What is this? All right. Again, you're allowed to talk to me by orange. Was 9/11 an inside job? Yes. Carried out by criminals in our own government working with Saudi Arabia. Leanne, let's get your take on that.
I agree. I won't even walk it back on that. There was just too much weird stuff, and it's...
And we've been proven right on that again.
Almost the 15-year anniversary of 9/11. I say it's time we get to the bottom of it. 28 pages proved that there were high-level Saudi officials, but guess who's still taking money from the Saudi government in high amounts?
Why don't you throw the orange right at me instead of rolling oranges?
Oh, my God.
We're going to start a new thing where we throw oranges.
Okay.
Hi-ya!
Oh, my
again,
God.
Again, all right. What was that question?
That you already answered that. Do you like oranges? Yeah.
Okay. Hi-ya! Sorry. Thor's,
oh, my God.
Thor's hammer. Well, hey, she's rolling oranges to get questions. It's totally normal. And, Leanne, that's my next question. I saw where major colleges are not going to let men compete in women's sports, and they've got, like, this track winner that keeps winning. It's really a man. They admit it. Mm-hmm. And I think that's totally normal. Because you can self-identify however you want.
Yeah. Muscle mass, bone density doesn't mean a thing.
Exactly. Did you know that Jimmy Dean pork sausage is now identifying as beef?
I did not know that.
And the FDA should let me, or EPA should let me say that, because it's racist if you know. And
well,
Jimmy Dean sausage can also use cow's restrooms now, even though it's a pig.
Well, I thought for the most part that kind of meat, you know, it poses itself as meat.
By the way, I'm not doing this as product placement of Jimmy Dean. I'm just telling you.
Their sales just went up.
Leanne.
Oh, my God. I'm getting out of here.
No, come back. Come back. Come back. It identifies as beef. Is that okay?
Is it identifying as meat?
What if it identifies as a paperweight?
Well, then I agree. It's a paperweight.
Wait. If it identified as a microphone, would it still work? Like, here, give me the Jiminy sausage, please. Now, if I wanted to broadcast on this, would it actually work if I magically said it did? What if I said it was a spaceship? A rocket? You see that?
It's a projectile.
All right, now let's get more serious. This is a chicken, according to racist homophobes.
More serious.
But it could identify as a pterodactyl.
I love pterodactyls.
Let me show you. It can fly. Soaring through the sky. There's no need to fear. Oh, pterodactyl chicken is here.
I feel so sorry for who has to clean the studio.
Don't worry. It wasn't actually. Now let's continue here. We've got Hillary saying,
I feel like I'm watching a Gallagher comedy show or something.
These are not carrots.
Are you going to sledgehammer watermelons?
Leanne, these are not carrots. These are, I don't know, what is their identity? They self-identify as?
Soulless gingers.
So that's a little, that's actually, this could be, they could identify as a soulless ginger. Hey, alien. Or as a Pinocchio, huh? Batman.
David Knight supposed
you
to?
You say you adapted the dog. I was born in the dark, Batman. Here you go.
I love how people ask, is Alex like this in real life when he gets off the air? This is Alex in real life, off the air.
Don't tell him all the secrets.
finger wagging at you.
Listen, when they attack me, I'm going to say, listen, they're the ones saying men can go in women's bathrooms and 300-pound guys should be on girls' little league teams. I mean, if a 300-pound 40-year-old guy wants to be on little girls' teams now, he can.
No,
and he can, like, tackle 5-year-old girls.
And don't be racist about it, Alex. It is what it is.
Actually,
and why?
These are ICBMs that Hillary sold the technology to Russia with. Watch this. Ah, Russia attack. You see that?
I'm not.
Attack missile. Ha! Hold on.
I'm not breaking the equipment.
Well, it's my equipment. Yeah, there you go. Look at that shot. You ever seen such precision? Watch this again, Leanne. Join me.
Camera pan?
Your armory. We will use it. Thank you, Batman. Yeah. There you go. See that?
Oh, so, my gosh.
Leanne, have you now entered the true insane asylum?
Yeah, card-carrying member now of the...
Anyways, Leanne.
I love getting
attack it.
Hair.
Attack it with
guns.
Pick up that... that missile.
I'll be the one to break something.
There you go. Don't call it a carrot, even though it looks like one. Like, this is even a hammer.
Please don't throw that.
At the camera? Batman. All right, seriously.
Bye.
No, you're acting cool.
Bye.
Leanne. Follow the teleprompters.
Else to smash. So
follow. Be serious. What's coming up tonight in serious coverage of the event?
Yes.
Where Hillary can't actually
the
be on
commander in chief forum, where it's like, do we even really need to ask who's going to be the better commander in chief? Look at Libya. We came, we saw he died. We have a woman.
Well, look at her. Look at her
money
stalling.
From Saudi
look
Arabia.
At her stalling. She can't do a real debate now. It's like, okay, ma'am, we'll leave you 30 minutes and then you can like place bets.
Look at ICE.
Will she have coughing fits tonight?
Ooh, I mean, how bad would that look for her? She's probably getting like Botox in her throat so that it relaxes.
I want to ask you, I want to have a poll. We can do polls on InfoWars.com right now. I'm going to add it by the end of the show, along with the viral video about the proof that there's election fraud coming. Everybody needs to get. I want to have a vote right now, InfoWars.com, the next 10 minutes. Will Hillary have a coughing fit? A. B. Will it be 10 seconds, 20 seconds, 30 seconds, or none?
Yeah. Oh, and will she spit more demons lozenges into her water?
Well, that's exactly. We're rolling oranges here.
What was it that she spit into her glass?
I say Martian babies. Those self-identify as Martian babies. The question is, will she spit out more little green Martian babies?
Little, I think those were like the demon seeds. Like just.
You know, there's a viral video where I talk about where roaches come from.
No.
It's Hillary Clinton.
Oh.
All right, Leanne, we're going out to break here in a moment. You'll be hosting tonight?
David and I believe Joe Biggs will be in here as well, just to kind of get his take on as a veteran.
Do you want me to show up?
I think that the public demands it.
Well, how can I top what we just did?
You can just call in and hack for us.
Trump just wants to catch a chicken over there. Later.
Please, you can't. Don't throw it.
We need to have her vomiting the green lozenges. We haven't even played that video today. See,
you
I have all this material.
The vomiting lozenges? Oh, my gosh. It's up on InfoWars.com right now. It's like, gross. Don't eat lunch while you're watching the video.
All right, Leanne, you're doing a great job. We'll talk to you at 7 o'clock Central tonight. InfoWars.com/show with the free feeds. There goes Wonder Woman. All right, David Knight, that was a little bit of fun. We're running a special 30 to 40% off on Storable Foods, 20% off on Survival Shield Nation 9X2. That supports the broadcast. People will attack me for having some fun, but after 4 hours, you got to have some fun when they've gotten so absurd. Now, we don't censor this and we don't prescript this. Do you agree with me? Or was this a little bit out of control, me throwing cows around? I mean, it self-identifies as a cow. It's no longer a chicken. David Knight.
Alex, I think that people ought to be able to write their questions on those lozenges that you gave out that email address for.
Exactly.
They can write their questions on a cough lozenge and send it to Hillary, because you know what? She's not going to read it anyway. You're not going to be able to get much of a question on her. She's not going to read it.
It'll be staged like a pickle jar?
Yeah, there you go. I thought it was, I'm kind of disappointed because I thought when I heard this, I thought it was going to be the commander and thief forum tonight. You know, with Trump is the commander and Hillary is the thief. But I just heard Leanne say it's the commander in chief forum. So we're going to take a look at that live tonight. Nightly news, 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern.
And then we'll have live coverage after that, too. Because we'll have a lot of tape stuff that we're doing.
We're going to take people's questions, yeah.
Take your questions and more. Great job, everybody, here. We had a little bit of fun at the end of the transmission. Please support the broadcast. Pray for us. And please get prepared, whether it's non-GMO, heirloom open pollinated seeds, or high-quality storable foods, or X2 survival iodine. It's all available at InfoWarsStore.com, and that makes it all possible. You are the oxygen of this operation. You can see the big effect we're having. All right, great job to the crew. We'll see you back in just a few hours, 7 o'clock Central, InfoWars.com. Please spread that link to everyone.